charged energy and an open mind to grasp and digest all the knowledge the students have for us. I would like to take a moment to remind everybody of the rules. Each presentation will be for 20 minutes, followed by a 20-minute session for the jury feedback and the questions from the audience. Everyone is requested to keep their cameras and mic off during the presentations. The audience is requested to post their questions in the question answer forum or the chat box. Please do not interrupt during the presentation and wait till the end of the presentation to share any comments or feedback. Moving ahead. Yes, ma'am.
I thought the ones who are presenting have to be online, have to have their videos on.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. The last topic covered the plight of the migrant laborers and the resilience of the cities in light of the ongoing pandemic. With the same spirit and enthusiasm, the next group brings to us their study, Adjusting to the New Normal. After almost 2 long years of the pandemic, educational institutes are finally starting to reopen in a careful and phased manner. There is a need to rework upon various architecture and design strategies to prevent the transmission of the virus in schools and provide for safe environments for all the students and staff. The upcoming team stresses that it is very important that the situation be looked at from a viewpoint of natural ventilation of the spaces. We now invite the team to take over.
Thank you, Ayushi. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm Sukhvinder Kaur, and I have with me Animesh Paliwal, Ashima Saini, Manan Jain, Jayant Negi, Danish Akram and Tejasvi Kolata as my co-author, and we did our research under the guidance of architect Gunjan Jain. So our research topic is Reconsider, Redesign, Retrofit. Can we pandemic-proof the schools? So according to the UNESCO report of September 2021, there are more than 28.6 crore students enrolled in schools in India. Out of these, 13.3 crore, that is almost half, are enrolled in secondary educational studies. In March 2020, following the lockdown guidelines, physical classes were suspended in all educational buildings all over India. All the students were heavily affected by the closing of schools. So what all has happened in the past 1.5 years in Delhi? So on 23rd March 2020, country went into a lockdown due to coronavirus outbreak with suspension of all physical education. On 18 January 2021, schools reopened for the first time after almost 10 months. Then in March 2021, second wave of coronavirus hit the country and physical classes were suspended again. On 1st September, schools reopened in a phased manner for 9th to 12th standard. And on October 2021, government declared the start of vaccination for 12 to 18 years old. After more than a year since the pandemic began, close to half the world's students are still affected by partial or full closure of schools, whereas over 10 crore additional students fall below the minimum proficiency level in reading. Although online classes replaced physical classes during the pandemic, but they were not accessible for a large part of the country's population. A survey conducted by the Times of India during the lockdown showed that the majority of students not engaged in any form of learning were those from the poorest of households. Among these sections also, girls were relatively more likely to have stopped attending classes than boys. So for this research, we conducted a survey on a sample size of 80 students from senior secondary classes attending schools in different urban areas in Delhi to understand the impact of lockdown on their overall well-being. According to the survey's results, majority of students experienced a decrease in physical activities, decreasing attention span, productivity, and social activities. Also, according to 24-hour movement guideline, teens should only get 2 hours of screen time a day. But during the lockdown, this average time almost doubled up than the recommended screen time. Also, physical well-being of the students were majorly affected, with majority of them experiencing headache, eye strain, weight gain, backache, weakened eyesight, and fatigue. Similar effects were seen on mental well-being of students, with majority of them reporting social disconnect, lack of motivation, stress, and anxiety. This all overall affected both the learning experience and academic performance of students, with majority of them also reporting a degrading healthy competition among peers, which otherwise results in overall well-being of students. Now, Ashima will take over from here.
Thank you, Sukhvinder. Now, all of these studies and survey results highlight the need to revert back to physical classes. However, now that the schools are starting to reopen in a phased manner, we must also note that the pandemic is not completely gone yet, and the risk of transmission is still there. Taking all these into consideration, our topic, therefore, discusses how building management guidelines and natural ventilation for school buildings in a composite climate can be improved without compromising thermal comfort. Through this study, we wanted to understand the need for natural ventilation, especially in this time of pandemic. We analyzed the implementation of guidelines issued by the government to reopen schools, and and with the help of these, we generated a metric recommendations relating to building management and ventilation that may help us create a safer learning experience. The study mainly focuses on the architectural domain without going deep into the engineering aspect of the topic. In this study, we will study the government issued guidelines for their efficiency in curbing the spread of the virus and their impact on indoor comfort levels. There are certain limitations to the study owing majorly to the fact that COVID-19 is a very recent phenomena and it is still evolving. Therefore, the data may prove to be incorrect or be altered at a later stage. Based on the literature available on the role of natural ventilation during the pandemic and the need to restart physical classes, the current research topic and aim were identified. In the data collection stage, case studies of schools, both primary and secondary, were done, and the collected data was then segregated into ventilation-related studies and building management guidelines. An online survey on secondary students was also done to support this research. This data was then analyzed with the help of existing guidelines and standards to generate a matrix of ventilation and building management solutions. Now, Tejaswi will talk about secondary case studies on COVID guidelines in schools.
Thank you, Ashima. COVID guideline assessment studies. Secondary case studies of school buildings were done to understand and assess the efficiency and implementation of COVID-19 management guidelines in schools in different parts of the world. So the first case study we have looked into was a masking experiment done in 17 K-12 schools in the US. And the insights were, number one, small cohort sizes and limited contact between cohorts was mostly responsible for the low levels of transmission detected in schools. Number two, student masking compliance was reported to exceed 92% throughout the course of the study. Older children were reported to be equally compliant and with masking as younger children. High levels of compliance helped mitigate in schools COVID transmission. The second study was design strategies released by American Institute of Architects for Safer Schools post-COVID. After conducting several experiments in different schools, AIA, American Institute of Architects, released management strategies to decrease the risk of transmission. These are few strategies which we can incorporate in schools and decrease the risk of transmission. Number one, increasing student occupancy by 2. Number two, ensuring additional touchless trash cans, hand washing basins, and sanitization stations are placed near entrances, providing touchless water drinking dispensers in corridors. Number three, providing disposable towels and disinfects for students to clean desks prior to and after use. Fixing furniture to limit mobility, which incorporates physical distancing and increasing the floor area as well. And number five, utilizing operable windows for outdoor air intake if possible. Now I request Animesh will talk about standards and guidelines.
Yes, so in the Indian context, we studied the following standards and guidelines to understand the space and ventilation requirements, which included the National Building Code, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research Guidelines, relevant Indian Standard Codes, and Delhi Disaster Management Authority guidelines. In the pre-pandemic scenario, the ventilation rate required in spaces was 20 to 30 meter cube per person per hour. But after the pandemic struck, the minimum ventilation requirements have changed to 36 meter cube per person per hour. So it is evident in the table that the air changes required per hour for majority of spaces have nearly doubled. The Delhi Disaster Management Authority has given the following guidelines to ensure safe reopening of the schools. This included regular symptoms check and hand sanitization of the students, attendance to be reduced to 50% with regular sanitization of the classroom. Maximizing entrances and exits to the classroom spaces with optimizing natural ventilation, staggering of the lunch breaks, and minimizing crowding of students at a place are few of the other recommendations given. Now, Manan will introduce our primary case studies.
Thank you, Animesh. Now, to study the implementation of the government guidelines for the schools in composite climate zone within urban context, primary case studies were done on two schools in New Delhi region. One is Delhi Public School, Mathura Road. It's a private day and boarding school. Second is Sarvodaya Kanya Vidyalaya, a government school managed by the Department of Education. Both the schools are naturally ventilated in their respective context. Based on our study, both the schools are successful in following the current DDMA guidelines in multiple ways, along with a few additional guidelines. Here we have circulation and the open built relationship for the DPS school. These two aspects are important to track COVID transmission. Key observations here are, first, single load corridors with adequate open spaces provide cross ventilation. Second, a single entry with temperature check. Third, multiple exit points with alternate travel routes to avoid congestion. Here we have the guidelines followed by the DPS and SKV. First is hand sanitization followed by symptom check at entry points. Second is alternate entry timings for students to avoid overcrowding. Next is the use of natural ventilation in classrooms and corridors all the time. Fourth is about the awareness, be it printed posters at DPS or hand-drawn by students at SKV. Next is about classroom occupancy. DPS achieves 40% by the option between physical or online classes, whereas SKV achieves 50% by alternate day schooling. Sixth is predefined markings on corridors to ensure physical distancing. Next is classroom sanitization at regular intervals, morning, lunch break, and afternoon. Also, group and sharing activities are avoided to ensure minimum contact. Next is a mandatory quarantine room with proper ventilation and segregation from other classrooms. We also observed additional guidelines followed by at the DPS school. One is the use of touchless sensors to avoid prevent infection by touch. Other one is shift towards single student desk to achieve efficient layouts along with physical distancing. Next, I invite Danish to introduce secondary studies.
Thank you, Manan. So we did another set of secondary case studies related to ventilation in buildings to understand how natural ventilation will affect the indoor environmental quality in the classroom and also virus transmission, and to understand what ventilation strategies can be adopted in existing buildings to increase the natural ventilation. So we looked at five case studies in climates similar to composite climates, and some information that was not valid to our context was filtered out, and we found out some general inferences from these case studies. That is, ventilation in buildings is responsible for the indoor environmental quality, which affects students' performance and ability to concentrate. So the indoor environment quality is influenced by lighting quality, thermal comfort, and indoor air quality. These case studies focused on indoor air quality and thermal comfort and looked at indoor air temperature, radiant temperature, air velocity for thermal comfort, and perceived air quality, ventilation rate, CO2 concentration for indoor air quality, with relative humidity being the common factor influencing both. So first of all, we gathered some general inferences from the five case studies, some general parameters like the floor area, orientation, WWR, WFR, occupancy, occupancy hours, and the orientation of all the classrooms. And then it was found that before the pandemic, more emphasis was given to thermal comfort in classrooms, such that the indoor air quality in classrooms was below acceptable standards for majority of the time spent. During and after the pandemic, the indoor air quality inside the classroom significantly improved due to opening of windows and limiting mechanical ventilation systems. But this in turn led to a decrease in the thermal comfort level of occupants. So it was observed in all of the case studies that to maintain a balance between both the indoor air quality and thermal comfort, passive strategies like wind towers, solar chimneys, or passive stacks can be used in conjunction with opening windows. In one case, even night flushing proved to be helpful in maintaining the balance. And in some case studies, windows were opened at regular intervals of 2 to 3 classes, and a balance between the indoor air quality and thermal comfort could be maintained for the majority of the time. So these passive strategies can also be adopted into existing buildings by retrofitting techniques. Now over to Jayant for the survey.
Thank you, Danish. So the next part of our research analyzed the survey results from a total of 80 responses from the senior secondary section of the schools in Delhi, majority of them being recorded from Lancers Convent, Laurel High, and SKV. These responses were recorded on three topics, namely impact of lockdown and online classes on a student's overall well-being, implementation of school reopening guidelines, and their efficiency, both of which had been discussed earlier. The third topic focuses on the relation of ventilation techniques to thermal comfort levels experienced by students as per Frangel's scale at different times of year. Moving on, the first set of surveys looked at the reasons for why windows are kept open during school hours, where 77.27% of the surveyed students admitted to have noticed a change in comfort levels. Also, 39% rated that the temperature regulation methods and ventilation strategies fall short of providing a comfortable indoor environment. The second survey results looked at the reasons for keeping the windows closed during school hours, where a majority of them closed windows as a result of outside noise, air pollution, and the use of indoor air conditioning. Third set reflects the effect of keeping the windows closed during school hours, with the data suggesting that it leads to suffocation, fatigue, and other health problems, indicating a great need for healthy ventilation in classrooms. Next, we have the inferences on student comfort, where it was found that the respondents sitting adjacent to windows had a high level of thermal discomfort during the summers and winters when compared to those seated elsewhere away from windows who had a neutral response towards thermal comfort. The next results shows that almost 68.5% of students are comfortable to take classes in open or semi-open spaces, although the main concern of the remaining who are not comfortable with open classes by outside noise, distractions, and weather conditions. So if we can cater to these, we can create more safe and healthier learning spaces. Now over to Sukhvinder to talk about the layout analysis.
Thank you, Jen. Considering that the outdoor air quality also creates many health risks for students in a highly polluted city like Delhi, it ultimately becomes a choice between mortality and morbidity, where we will have to choose to naturally ventilate classrooms, neglecting the outdoor pollution to ultimately prevent the risk of contracting the virus. Hence, we studied different classroom layouts from our primary studies in Delhi on the basis of their window wall ratio, a parameter that affects the energy needed for heating, cooling, and lighting of buildings, window flow ratio that is used to determine the potential of using external air for ventilation, and rate of ventilation, which is the rate at which external air flows into the building. So our first case study, Delhi Public School, has a courtyard kind of typology with two types of layout. Layout one is having single-sided ventilation, while the second layout has cross ventilation, and these are the classroom pictures from both the layouts. So our second primary case study, Sarvodaya Kanya Vidyalaya, has a double-loaded corridor with a good open-to-built relationship. It has single-sided ventilation in all the classrooms, and these are the pictures of one of the classrooms. Now looking at the comparative analysis of all these layouts, it was inferred that layout 1 is not achieving the minimum window to flow ratio and the minimum rate of ventilation for single-sided ventilation in schools for COVID scenario. This is mainly due to the large classroom volume needed to be ventilated by a small openable window area. In layout 2, although it was cross-ventilated, it is not able to achieve minimum rate of ventilation mainly because of smaller openable windows on the west wall. Only layout 3 is achieving the minimum ventilation rate due to large openable windows ventilating a smaller volume of room, but it is exceeding its limit of 40% window wall ratio, resulting in heat gain and glare. Now I invite Ashima to talk about our recommendations for school buildings.
Thank you, Sukhvinder. With the help of all these studies, we generated a matrix of both permanent and temporary measures regarding building management and ventilation recommendations for both existing and new schools that will be built. In building management, first, we looked at social and circulation solutions. Some of the temporary solutions are creating awareness about the virus and encouraging students and staff members to follow physical distancing protocols using posters and signages. The number of entry and exit points can be increased, or an interval of at least 30 minutes can be provided between the arrival and departure times of different classes to avoid crowding in corridors. Corridors can also be marked with arrows to show circulation, and a 15-minute break after every two class hours can be provided to decrease prolonged seating in one space. For physical distancing, single student seating desks can be used with alternate seating arrangement patterns as a temporary solution. Whereas staggering and fixing the furniture in place with a minimum 6 feet distance between desks could be a permanent solution. For maintaining hygiene on the premises, disposable hand towels and napkins can be kept in each classroom. Maximizing the use of touchless appliances or step and pull handles for doors, bathroom fixtures, lifts, sanitizer dispensers, etc. can be seen as a permanent solution. For ventilation, fans should be used along with open windows to maximize dilution ventilation. During extreme winters or times when keeping the windows open for long intervals is not possible, windows can be opened after every two class hours for a period of 15 minutes to ventilate the classroom. Now, Jayant will talk about retrofitting solutions regarding natural ventilation for existing schools.
Thank you, Ashima. Now we have interventions that suggest some retrofitting techniques relating to ventilation. First being the temporary measures that incorporate cooling by opening windows during night and using wing walls to improve single-sided ventilation. The permanent measures include increasing the area of openable windows to have a minimum of 12 air changes per hour, using staggered openings for natural ventilation while blocking out the noise, using solar chimneys in conjunction with the above methods. Next is to incorporate an automatic window control system and schedule window openings after two class hours for approximately 15 minutes. The last one is to make use of green plants outside the classroom window below cell level to allow fresh air to enter into the space while also maintaining a good indoor air quality. Now over to you, Danish.
Yeah. Next, we have design interventions for new school buildings. So coming to planning of schools, the width of the building or classroom can play a huge role in the ventilation quality. Limiting it to 7.65 meter can provide ample natural ventilation. Irregular building shapes which are properly designed can also enhance natural ventilation as they have large variations in pressure. Then schools with singly loaded corridors also have better ventilation, and this can be combined with a courtyard typology also. Coming to the arrangement of classrooms in doubly loaded corridors, gaps can be left after two consecutive classrooms, which would bring in air while also functioning as a kind of a semi-open space between two consecutive classrooms. And for physical distancing, classrooms could be given more outdoor spaces, being a combination of open and semi-open areas.
Now, to conclude, we want to say that we need to be prepared with countermeasures for any future outbreaks. It is necessary to reconsider and recreate learning spaces equipped with proper strategies and systems which can prevent disease transmission and can overall create healthier and livable indoor environment for overall development of students. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to post their questions in the Q&A forum or the chat box.
Something's not here.
Yeah. I'm here. Very much here. Anubha, aap shuru karo. I'll join later.
So, so comprehensive. I don't think I have much to add because most of the suggestions that you had were common sense. And I think given the situation, they would have to be incorporated. Although I do feel that it probably works as a hybrid system, not hybrid in terms of online, offline, but hybrid as in terms of full capacity and partial capacity, depending on what the state of the pandemic or other such issues may be. So in terms of the research or the findings, I don't think I have to comment much because I think they're mostly in place and that is what common sense would dictate. I just have one question on the process, which is when you have the survey and you have some, some detailed survey findings, you know, the first few slides that you had where you had the pie charts. I wanted to know, how was the survey conducted, and was this a Google form, and who constructed the questions and why? How was the survey designed? Somebody?
Yes, ma'am. So, ma'am, it was a Google survey. We conducted in online and we circulated the form in various senior secondary students, to various senior secondary students in schools in Delhi. And regarding the questions, basically we researched a few online surveys and how the questions are constructed. And we had a common theme, like what kind of, what we are experiencing right now in lockdown, and what might be students be experiencing also. So, yeah.
Okay. Why I'm asking is, I'm not questioning your process, because yes, of course, I mean, there are certain things that you do, and Google Forms is an easy way of doing it. My only concern, if at all, is that when you construct or frame a question, you are in a way also framing the answer. You see, because what you ask is almost, it's almost anticipated. I mean, you may not consciously anticipate, but it is something that it will probably be, it will be answered in a particular way, because human beings are creatures of conditioning. And therefore, survey design becomes an extremely extremely nuanced exercise. And while I don't expect you to get into that degree of nuance, because we're also frankly not taught how to do it, and it's not possible. I mean, architecture is seekh lo, baaki baad mein seekh lena. But just to keep in mind that it's not as straightforward as posting some questions online, because the way you frame a question is pretty much dictates what answers to expect. And to get really, really kind of insightful answers, it's another level of designing surveys. So just that comment. But well done, I think it was.
You had some diagrams showing typical arrangements of classrooms and all that. Could you have a look at that? I think your research paper had those sketches. I came across. Thana kuch? Where you have shown the layouts of the schools and the way the classrooms are staggered and things like that. Kuch hai kuch?
So like we had the layout of the schools that we studied in the primary.
Yeah, I think I saw some. Yeah, these are the ones. Yes, just a second. Yes. No, do you have a sketch where the grouping of classrooms are shown? No.
So it is for the Delhi public school.
Okay. No, ek aur tha kuch. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe something else. Just show the detailed thing, slide of the classroom, the one earlier shown.
Oh, yes.
Yes. See the question here is, you know, this is a common, it's a very typical situation. I'm talking of the diagram number 2 that you have, or for that matter number 3. Yeah, DPS, one is first, second one is DPS, the third one is SKV. Now the question is, you know, do you think it's a very good, you know, the idea, I mean, this has to do with ventilation as well as general circulation of people in the school. The way the windows are, the windows facing the corridor, are they openable?
Yes, they were openable.
But would it not hinder the movement of people walking there?
Actually, the windows were opening from the inside.
Achha, under so, okay. But is that a good way of doing it?
Also, sir, I would like to.
I know you didn't design it. I'm just simply because. We face this problem every time somebody designs a school for thesis or for any other project.
We also saw a school in a case study of a school in Bangalore where they were using staggered openings.
So, no, this is another very simple thing, a device, I would say, where you detach the corridor from the classroom.
Yeah.
Right? So, you create a kind of a, what do you call, like a shaft. Not a shaft really, because open on either side. You create a passage, you know, air passage next to the classroom.
Yeah.
That helps you to open the windows and also keeps the noise level to a tolerable extent.
Otherwise, carry on.
So these are some of the things, you know, which are very, and it's not as if it's something new. It has been, is being done for a long time, that kind of device, you know, so that, and then also you divide as far as the general planning of the school is concerned, you see to it that the students moving in, they kind of distribute over the school, not take one particular route to reach your classroom, so creating noise and crowded conditions. So that's I think other thing was that, you know, that your survey of schools in England, was it in England? One was in.
Yes, sir. One of them was in England.
Do you have a picture of that? Yes, you have one. Do you have something?
In fact, one of the. We didn't have a picture, but.
Okay. Okay.
We had a schematic plan.
Okay, Nisme, what exactly you're trying to illustrate in this?
So this school was using passive ventilation stacks through windows and chimneys. So they in this study they had measured the indoor air quality at different classrooms and also the thermal comfort levels.
Okay, so how what does this lead to, with this information that you have got? What are you trying to pinpoint?
So in this school, actually, on the lower classrooms, the indoor air quality was good, but in the upper level classrooms, the window openings were smaller in size.
Okay.
So because of that, the indoor air quality wasn't up to the acceptable standards. And also there was a lot of radiant heat in the upper classrooms. And also as there was a computer lab on the upper classrooms, there was a lot of radiant heat.
See, unfortunately, these are not exactly comparable to Indian conditions. You know, I mean, this is I think they're nice in terms of, you know, case studies and all that. But I think next time onwards, you know, you must look for examples which are more relevant to our climatic conditions and things like that. You have made a point. It's not that this is meaningless.
This study was only conducted during the summers. And any information that was not applicable to our or to the composite climate, we had filtered it out.
Mm-hmm. Also, sir, when you are beginning at the time frame we had for a study, initially the Indian schools hadn't reopened, so we didn't have data analyzing for those areas. So we looked for outside India context studies which had opened and had some solutions done in the schools, and then finally the DPS and SKV case studies were able to do when they reopened with some limited attendance.
I wanted to add when Samud said that you can detach the corridor from the classroom and get that opening that moves the classroom away from the main corridor and all that. You could even increase the thickness of the wall. I mean, you could have storage from the classroom side. So the windows open on the sill, you know. So while you can open the window and not want to hurt anybody.
True.
Okay. So that's another option. Yeah. You can't just leave a corridor and open these windows into the corridor because it will hurt somebody. And at the stage of the, it will obviously
and invariably they'll keep it closed throughout the year. Yeah. I mean, irrespective of the climate, they'll keep it closed. So that's the problem. Anyway, good. Okay.
Okay.
Is there anything else coming up?
I have asked a question in the question box or whatever it's called.
Yes. So we have a couple of questions for you, team. So the first is, while the question. They agree that the ventilation is of utmost importance. Don't you need to deliberate on the air quality index outside? Yesterday, the air quality index was hazardous.
Yes, ma'am. So like when we consider air quality, it majorly poses many health risks. But in a situation like this, we have to choose between two things, like that is mortality and morbidity. So we'll have to choose mortality. That is
a situation where it's very difficult to, you know, to filter the air that's outside and have the air coming in.
True.
But you did not mention this.
The devil in the deep sea, as they say.
Yeah, you have to mention it. Yeah. It's very, very serious, this business, you know. You can't have that dirty air coming into your room. carry on.
Thank you, ma'am.
Team, the second question to you is from Mr. Raman. He's asking you to please elaborate what is the role, if any, of ventilators or openings above 8 feet height can play in facilitating effective classroom cross ventilation. Somebody from the group may take the question.
Yes, so we did a case study in which we had these kind of classrooms where there were 4 ventilators on at the top. So it was observed that, of course, when the ventilators were used in conjunction with opening windows, the indoor air quality inside the classroom had improved significantly. So, yeah, ventilators can play a huge role in improving the indoor air quality.
That's true, and you know the tendency is for the air is to rise up, and so it will automatically find a way out from a higher window ventilator. It makes sense, and if the windows are placed at different heights, even better. So it sweeps the entire air inside the room, outside. There will be no static air in the upper part of the room.
Yes,
absolutely, Danish. Just wanted to reiterate that. This is also a possible solution to have an opening towards the corridor side.
Yeah.
7 feet height. Openings placed on opposite side of the walls can facilitate cross ventilation as much by 30% to 40% more and faster.
True.
Yes.
It's being used effectively across, and since I did not see any mention of it, thought that let it be discussed a bit. Rest all seems to be well covered. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I think I've already mentioned, I haven't looked at the link I sent with the Midambika school designed by Sanjay Prakash in the late 80s. I mean, though it wasn't meant to be designed for pandemic, but it served the function very well. The idea was to have a wall-less classroom. Which is also, it's all naturally ventilated. It's not an air-conditioned school. The windows open. These are pivot windows which open outside onto a green area. And the inside is a singly loaded corridor which overlooks a courtyard, which is also green. And it doesn't have any windows, but it's amply ventilated. Have a look. I've put a link. You'll see some pictures there.
Would that be all?
Sir, I just want to add one point regarding the air quality. That is mostly in Delhi, it is bad during the winter months. So if we schedule the window openings during the daytime, like after say 10 or 11, when there's enough sun, so maybe we can deal with it to an extent, not opening the windows early in the morning. So that could be one of the solutions to deal with the pollution and at the same time ventilation.
Yeah, you're right. You can, but the with the sun, the pollution outside gets a little less. It doesn't go away completely.
A mixing height changes as the sun rises, so it will be higher below, above the level where we breathe. So it could be manageable. Definitely, we cannot prevent it.
Yeah.
But to an extent.
It's like going out for a morning walk a little late.
Yeah, yeah.
Instead of going out at 7 o'clock, you go at 9 or something.
Yeah. Right, sir. That's right. So we can schedule the window openings.
Okay.
There are some methods wherein a balance between CO2 level versus pollutants can be achieved by using some technologies which are available. There was a paper written on this aspect. I'll just share it on the inbox here. Maybe the students can have a look on that, because a certain aspect which is very important here to be highlighted is that rise in CO2, and there's a Harvard study done in 2006 on this. It impacts the cognitive faculties to a great level, and that is one thing we do not want to compromise in school environment. So it would do good if you can just check out that and bring more width to the aspects of performance effect, because it's not only this is a PM 2.5 or PM 10 that we are talking here. We are also looking at a balance between O2 and CO2. So I'll just try to share that paper. Maybe it can help. Thank you.
Yes, sir. I had actually looked at a similar paper where this was mentioned, how the indoor environmental quality affects the students' performance. And it was also mentioned that the things like lighting quality also, which affected the students' performance and concentration in a classroom.
Okay. So where are we now? Do we go on to the next, or is there any more questions coming up?
I think we can move on to the next one.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for your comments. I'm sure the team will dwell upon the feedback. We also thank the audience for the interesting questions. I think, ma'am, we have another question for the team. So I'm just reading it out for you. As one of you remarked, I like the idea of designing a breakout space after every two classrooms because it helps with ventilation and provides children a different perspective and an open environment. But in terms of design, have you considered any other options? Do you think that taking a break after two classrooms is the most efficient design method?
So I haven't considered any options, any other options, but what I was thinking is that these breakout spaces can be integrated with the classrooms only. For example, during the months when the climate is good, some of the classrooms could be conducted outside in the semi-open spaces. So basically that breakout space and that classroom space, both of them would be integrated, and classrooms could and classes could be conducted either indoors or in the semi-open spaces depending on the weather. I was thinking that those two things can be integrated together, so it might be more efficient then.
Something interesting has come up now. If you see some of the recent designs, for example, in some of the schools in Japan and other places, they're utilizing the roof of the school building in a more very creative way, in the sense that you ramp up the roof in a way. They're very, very famous design that is a lot of people are circulating everywhere. A lot of people are using this ideas in the thesis also. So the roof itself becomes a large place, you know, where a lot of things can happen. It provides access to the classrooms and also for playing and things like that. And as you were saying, conducting open air classes and things like that. So I think in days to come, I think roofs should become very important. It will not be simply a place for water tanks and other things. It will become a more active kind of space.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
Okay.
Now I hand over the stage to Joanne.
Yes. Thank you, Aishi. The last group has given us some insight into the reopening of schools and what it means for children. Life for children has been very difficult with the pandemic, especially with them not being able to comprehend the situation. And what about the children in informal settlements, such as bastis, which are affected much worse than ours? To understand that, we call upon our next group to present their research on childhood in the bastis and COVID-19.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Osama Zia Khan, and along with me, I have Mukhil, Riju, Ramya, Ram, and Ehsan, and also our guide, Dr. Shubhajit Sarkar. Play or pandemic. Our topic is impact of COVID-19 pandemic on the development of children in bastis. Through this study, we aim to understand how the lives of children living in these informal settlements, particularly in the bastis of Delhi and Mumbai, was affected with the outbreak of COVID-19. We also aim to understand the healthy development of a child in a Basti and also propose interventions for the same. According to UN Habitat Sustainable Goals, a slum, informally known as a Basti household, is defined as a group of individuals living under the same roof, lacking one or more of the following conditions: access to improved water, access to improved sanitation, housing durability, sufficient living area, security of tenure. This is a graph that shows the percentage of urban population living in slums in India. As we can see, there is a constant decline in percentage until 2014, which goes less than 25%, after which there has been a sudden spike in the percentage. And as of 2018, the percentage was 35.2%. There are over 7.6 million children in India right now between the ages of 0 to 6 years who are living in these bastis and have been adversely affected directly or indirectly by the COVID-19 pandemic. This is the population that is dependent on their caregivers for not only their means of survival, but also healthy development. UNICEF and WHO gave a framework for nurturing care, which includes parameters like healthcare and nutrition, protection from harm and a sense of security, opportunities for early learning and responsive caregiving. Our study is primarily based on these five parameters. Healthy development of a child is very important. Based on the parameters of the previous slide, we divided healthy development into three broad categories: physical well-being, education, and social well-being. Further, physical well-being was divided into six categories: the maternal and neonatal period, nutritional status, mental health and development, frequency of infectious diseases, exposure to and perpetration of violence, unintended accidents and injury. Based on a primary research question to study the impact of COVID-19 on the Basti children of Mumbai and Delhi, we asked the following questions. Has there been access to proper and basic sanitation? What effect did the closing down of schools have? And how did it affect the mental and physical health of these children living in the Bastis? What role do open spaces of play have in daily lives of children? And what impact did COVID-19 have on the availability of jobs and demand in Bastis? Now I would like Riju to continue the presentation.
For the purpose of the study, our scope were the Bastis in Delhi and Mumbai. We conducted primary research through personal interviews, secondary research through case studies of Dharavi and Bhalswa. And we also conducted, we collected data from quantitative survey connected by NIUA. An earlier assessment of the situation in Bastis indicates the following shifts in paradigms as we shifted from an offline to an online mode. Education shifted to an online platform. Healthcare infrastructure collapsed. Sanitation and availability of water became extremely critical, and social distancing norms became impossible to follow in densely populated neighborhoods. Due to rampant unemployment, availability of nutritious food declined, which compromised immunity as well as created increased cases of domestic violence. All of this combined created an unhealthy environment for the children to develop in. If we elaborate further on education, most Basti children go to schools where teaching standards are low and classrooms may be under-equipped. Most of these children are also first-generation learners, which is why they are usually go to tuition classes. Due to the lockdown, their tuition classes stopped, and the online classes also created a strain on their education. When we look at physical well-being in areas of play, while in theory, investment in parks is seen as benefiting all children, in practice, the temptation is always to protect these newly beautified parks that are created through government schemes, etc., from Basti kids who are perceived as vandals. Basti improvement plans would therefore benefit greatly if natural enhancements to the slum neighborhoods are done by looking at Bastis as a vital piece of the city. If we look at nutrition, due to the pandemic, the children who would generally rely on midday meal schemes for their nutritional needs were greatly dependent on the government schemes later on. if you move to the next slide, using a survey, we found that the share of households where children receiving midday meals in the cities of Mumbai and Delhi were extremely low, with only 6.6 and 4.2% households receiving midday meals from schools. The Delhi government started distributing dry ration as a part of the midday meal scheme for nursery children till the class 8. And in Mumbai, this lack of nutrition was being supplemented by NGOs by providing cooked meals to the children in these bastis. When we look at spatial restrictions, the higher the density of a city, the higher the congestion, and that would also increase the average number of people per household in the bastis. When we look at Delhi and Mumbai, which are highly densely populated cities, we also see that the average number of people per a room is almost close to 4. Also looking at the sense of security, there are places in the bastis where there is a lack of employment option, and especially during the pandemic, a lot of people lost their jobs, which limited the amount of safe recreational spaces that the children had available to them. And that also increased their access to illegal substances and their participation in gang violence. And this lack of employment has also resulted in a higher report of domestic violence in children during and after the pandemic. This has also resulted in a negative impact on their mental health because of the insecure and violent atmosphere around them, where we observed that the children also had unusual sleeping patterns and irritability during the pandemic. Also, the sudden access to digital media because of the online mode of education reported unusual behavior in children, with issues like lack of concentration also starting to grow. We also observed that the cases of child marriage, if you could move, yeah. We also observed that the cases of child marriage increased during the pandemic, where families thought, if I die, what will happen to my family? They felt like it was their duty to get their children married early. And then we also observed that the children with special need, who would usually rely on structure and routine for their lives under normal circumstances, also were introduced to a lot of stress and disruption in their lives. And all of these many changes shifted their understanding on how they could keep themselves safe. These are all children who rely on their caregivers for their healthy development. I would like to ask Ramya to continue on with the case studies now.
So like Riju mentioned, we have taken secondary case studies in Delhi and Mumbai. So our first case study is the Bhalsawa slum, with a total population of 40,000 people and a population density of 2,630 people per hectare. So the Bhalsawa slum had developed when the Jangirpuri area was sort of developed with the metro and all, and the people were promised some basic amenities. But what happened was, after that, the landfill had severely affected the amenities that these slum dwellers received. In terms of healthcare, Bhalsawa, even before the pandemic hit, had witnessed about 5,200 deaths per year due to waterborne diseases that were majorly caused due to the contaminated water from the landfill. And also about 50 people share a single unclean toilet every day over here. This contaminated water also had a major impact on the health of the children, and then impacting their education as well. What happened because of the extremely poor quality of water is that the children had very compromised immunity. They grew up fighting just the germs in the water, that their body was not even able to absorb the nutrition from the food they were having. So this made the children weak and vulnerable to the infection more easily. And like Riju mentioned, that the midday meals are also not there. And as we can see here, the dissolved solvents in water is a permissible level of 2,000, but in the areas in and around Bhalsawa, it was found to be about 6,000. In terms of opportunities of learning, the resources are very scarce in the slum. There are very less number of schools. There's one primary school, there's one co-ed school and one girls' school. So the student-to-teacher ratio is extremely low. And a lot of children in the slum were not able to afford. So a lot of them work during the day, like doing rack picking and odd jobs, and then they try to study in the evening. And in terms of sense of security, the open spaces in Bhalsawa are fragmented, amongst the living spaces, and there's no proper public space where the children can gather and play. What this does is that there's a lack of sense of security within the children for using common resources in their slum. And conclusively looking at how this the pandemic has affected them, like I mentioned, the major factors were landfill and contaminated water, leading to compromised immunity amongst the children. What also happened was that there was a sudden increase in the population in the slum because the migrant workers had settled here when they couldn't go anywhere when the lockdown was imposed. Because of this, there was social distancing became almost impossible in the slum during the pandemic. So I would like Ram to now explain our second case study.
Yeah, so good afternoon everyone. Continuing further with our secondary case study, which was the Harawi slum in Mumbai, which is one of the largest slums in Asia with a population of 8.5 lakh people living on a total area of 2.4 square kilometers. So if you talk about sanitation in Harawi, more than 50% of the total population of Harawi actually depend upon public toilets for their sanitary requirements. This need is satisfied by 750 odd community toilet blocks, which were made under the slum sanitation program by the World Bank. If we do a simple calculation, these toilets actually are one for 190 users, which is way more than the accepted BMT norms of one toilet per 50 people. The pressure on these SSP toilets are further reduced by 30,000 odd free-to-use MHADA toilets, which are pay-to-use. Also, there was a BMC survey in 2016, which actually revealed that 58% of these SSP toilets did not have electricity, and 78% of these did not even have water, which further contributes to, you know, children who find it difficult to use these toilets, you know, queuing up in lines, and further there's no electricity, so it also stops them from using it during the night. To cater to these problems, BMC actually came up with a plan to build a Suvidha Center, which would be 26,000 square meters big, and it would have all facilities, including 100 clean flushing toilets for men, women, children, and also with, for people with disabilities. But there was no further data if the project actually even met its goal. So talking about nutrition, since the pandemic had hit Harawi, there has been pretty less research on the slums and how people are doing. So the study was done actually before pandemic, but it actually showed cases of stunting, wasting, anemia, and underweight in people, in children of Harawi in their neonatal age. Next slide. Unlike many other slums, Harawi actually has a lot of educational initiatives which are done by many NGOs and organizations. One such organization is Reality Give, which has been in action in Harawi since 2016. They have more than 9,000 beneficiaries till now. And one of the peculiar things about them is they work for community betterment. So most of the people they employ are from Harawi itself, and they also provide courses for all-over course, which can help children to, you know, proceed further in the careers afterwards. Another foundation known as ICON actually works for rag pickers and to, you know, give them recognition by BMC as one of the major factors that help in keeping Mumbai clean. Also, after the pandemic hit, CTFI partnered with the Harawi Foundation to provide tablets and 1 GB of internet to more than 1,000 students to enable their online education. Now, talking about the government schemes, the government actually initiated the Harawi redevelopment program, according to which private developers could buy that land at a cost which was 25% less than the market rate at the time, with just one requirement that they have to provide 30% of that land area for rehabilitation to the slums. So even though the scheme was working on paper, but there was no guideline on the quality of these compartments that were being built. So studies show that most of the compartments do not even have electricity or plumbing fixtures. And in all, even though the slum area was being reduced on paper, but actually, it was just creating more vertical slums. One other thing about Harawi was that its COVID-19 model was praised even by WHO, which included 4 T's of tracing, tracking, testing, and treating. This actually helped in stemming the growth of infection thoroughly. But once we studied in an article on November 9, 2020, the official case count was 2359 COVID cases from Dharavi, which is just 0.27% of its population. But there was a study for a research on asymptomatic infections, which was done on September 2020, which revealed that out of all of the samples collected from the slums, 57% of them had COVID-19 antibodies. Now, since all this time is about the first wave of pandemic when we did not have vaccines, so the only way a person could have antibodies was after they contracted the virus, which showed that even though commendable efforts were done and the case count was low, but the transmission actually never stopped in Dharavi. So, yeah. Further, Mukhil would take on our primary research.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. So we did primary interviews on parents, children, and teachers in slums and in the bastis of Delhi. And we also talked to an NGO, basically the Better Balswa, which is a non-government organization trying to working for the betterment of Balswa. Next slide. We will now be looking at a few cases from the interviews. So we have Nisha, a parent who is 32 years old. So what she said is they were able to access medical help because of the Aam Aadmi Mohalla clinics of the Delhi government, as well as the Mahavir Hospital, both of which provided free access to them. Also, the free rations and the reduction in fees helped them a lot. And they were also able to buy those resources like the smartphones required for online education, but they still faced the problem of limited internet connectivity. We have Mukesh, a parent, 37 years old, who, according to him, he said that his work stopped for almost a year. His students who were going to tuitions had to stop because he couldn't pay for them anymore. And they were also completely dependent on the government provided ration on a few days. And Rajesh, his family, they were not able to access medical help during the pandemic. And they also said that the free ration and reduction of school fee, which would have helped them a lot, was not delivered to them. They were not able to access it. Next. We also interviewed Nitin and Vijay, two children, 8 and 9 years old. So according to them, they prefer the offline mode of schooling because in online, they have nothing to do but to just study all the time, and they don't have play areas near their homes. While as compared to offline schooling, they can meet with their friends and they can, play different kinds of sports. Yeah, and they are also provided government rations, which was distributed in their school. Next. Abba, a parent, 34 years old, says that she was only able to buy the smartphone, the necessity for the online mode of learning, before the second lockdown. She had to save her money till the second lockdown, after which she was able to buy the resource, and then the children were able to access online learning. And Priya, a child, 16 years old, says she said that her fees in her school, the fees after 9 were excused, and students who were not able to afford laptops or phones were provided by the government in that school. So from our interviews, we also saw that most of the families, they didn't have washrooms built inside their homes. Most of them, they all use their community washrooms, which are not well maintained and completely unsanitary. And all the households except for one live in single or double room homes, which approximately measured up to 12 to 15 square meters. Hence, quarantine is not an option for them. And most of these, most of the people we interviewed, their jobs were daily wage and monthly wage jobs, like e-rickshaw drivers, cab drivers, tailors, housemaids, etc. So because of this, due to the COVID-19 lockdowns, they faced a reduction in their salary and wages, due to which they were not able to buy food, they were dependent on government rations, and they were not able to, buy smartphones, laptops, etc. for their children to access online education. Yeah, now we have Asin talking about the inferences.
Good afternoon, everyone. So based on the studies and research, there are certain conclusions that we have achieved. So firstly, the studies indicate that one of the primary risks to children living in the bastis in Delhi and Mumbai is the lack of sanitation. So that leads to health issues. This concern was elevated because of the pandemic. Also, the midday meal scheme also got suspended due to the closing of schools. Although the government schemes are there to provide rations and compensations to the families in Basti's. It is important to notice that these ration foods do not have good quality food. So this actually resulted in compromised immunity to the children. Also, 50% of the children that we have interviewed did not have ample opportunities of play as they do not have appropriate spaces in surrounding areas. Also, the pandemic also ruptured various welfare schemes that were run by the government, such as the Integrated Child Development Services Scheme. Children are clearly losing out on their early childhood care and educational provided through the Anganwadi centers. The pandemic has forced the welfare workers, mainly the Anganwadi workers, to work in COVID-19 response activities rather than utilizing their services in these children programs. So hence, they are no longer available for giving a special focus on the educational and nutritional requirements of the children. Apart from the sanitation, security is another important aspect of important aspect that is associated with the community toilets in slums. So the children often fear standing in long queues and going to the toilets at nights. And community toilets in Basti's become a common point of violence, making it unsafe for the children. Also, talking about the education system, which was already struggling with a low teacher-to-student ratio, took a greater hit when the mode of education shifted to online classrooms, which led to a lack of resources for the children at home. Sudden access to online devices also resulted in many children showing unusual behaviors like irritability. Based on all the studies that we have shown, and like we would like to propose some recommendations. So first of all, like primary issue that heavily impacts healthcare in the Basti's is improper sanitation. So the number of toilets in the Basti's must be adequate and appropriately sanitized as per the WHO guidelines. Also, more resources must be allocated to provide necessary good quality education with appropriate student-teacher ratio and quality equipments, including devices like smart boards and laptops. Also, like in Delhi, additional rations were allotted, whereas in Mumbai, many NGOs began providing cooked meals to children in Basti's in Mumbai after the midday meal came to a halt in lockdown. So there are a couple of already implemented proposals that we would also like to talk about. So one of them is Mohalla Clinic by Aam Aadmi Party. So the Aam Aadmi Party Clinic is conceptualized as a means to provide quality primary health care in every locality in Delhi. The physical infrastructure is made up of pre-engineered insulated box that is movable, and the whole structure is actually movable. So these are manufactured and installed through the PWDs. And we can actually use more of these units and scale them up to provide health care to the neglected areas of these cities.
Just to add a point about the thing Yasin was mentioning about the Mohalla Clinic, is that a temporary solution like this in sort of becomes a permanent asset for the slum dwellers and the Basti people. And another initiative is Better Balswa by the graduates of SPA Bhopal, where they're designing public spaces and social infrastructure for the Balswa Basti, and they're involving and engaging the community in it. And here, this initiative is also to make a play space for the children of the Balswa slum, and they've involved all of them in the design process. So this was an initiative taken by the government of Tamil Nadu in 2011, where lots of children of the government schools were provided with laptops for their education. So in conclusion, what we felt was there are some initiatives that have been taken before, and there are some schemes that can really help the children in this in a situation like this in an epidemic. It's just that some of them maybe have not been implemented properly, and that there is proof that there are a lot of schemes that have worked like this in the country in the past. So we can do our best to give them and give them a better resources and to get them a better future. Thank you.
Yes, sir. So basically coming to the conclusion, to conclude, the childhood experience by children who grew up in these, you know, informal settlements often goes against the idea of the universal childhood and innocent childhood. But this does not mean that these children have no, you know, childhood. They just have one that's different to us, seeing them, you know, playing in rugged terrain, playing multiple roles in their daily lives, and sharing responsibilities with the other adults of the family. With this, we conclude our presentation on the impact of COVID-19 on the development of children in Basti's. We thank you for listening to our presentation, and we're now open for questions and feedback.
Thank you, team, for your presentation. I would now like to request the jury to give the team their feedback and for the audience to post their questions in the Q&A forum.
With the permission, I'll start the thing. Anubha, is she here? Yeah. So my question is not a question really. I mean, what would be your closing argument for all that you have done? What is the eventual ultimate statement that you're going to make? If you have a statement that you have to make about your presentation, how would you say it? You understood my question? What is the crux of this whole exercise? What is it that you're trying to say?
If I may.
Yeah, please.
So with this entire presentation, we were trying to study the impact on the lives of children. So in our conclusion, we would say that it has the pandemic has adversely affected the lives of children who were already struggling for their means of survival. So till now, while we were studying the interventions that have taken place for their upliftment, we did not find any concrete solutions to the problems that were previously there and have been further elevated after the pandemic. So we would like to bring this to our attention to the forefront that slum redevelopment programs should also focus on vulnerable groups of the society, including the children. So there should be special provisions in the development schemes that are looking at children in particular.
Okay.
So that is what.
Sir, another point would also be like there were some schemes in the past which were not in light of the pandemic. Like when we highlighted about the laptop scheme in Tamil Nadu, that was not for a pandemic. It was during a normal time. But if we think about it now, when people can't afford online, like they couldn't afford education itself. So online education is far from their reach. So something like that, if it would have been implemented now, it would have given a great sort of reach for the children in the Basti to access education. So our conclusion and our aim was to get that out, to get light on the lives and what it is like for them and how it's worsened from the pandemic, and that there are situations that were done before that can better their lives now, that are initiatives by NGOs and governments.
Your work is very structured, well, and very well researched. You know, I think I've done a lot of research on this and all that. The other thing I wanted to point out was that for example, this Dharavi is quite different from Valsava. In that sense, in a lot of people say Dharavi is not even a slum. It's like a bit of the city, it's a large part of the city, and it has a very thriving running industry inside. They have a whole lot of workshops, offices, agencies, all kinds of things are there. So it's technically it is not probably comparable to Valsava in that sense. Valsava is in a much degraded state. Much degraded than Dharavi is. Dharavi has also the same problems of garbage and dirt and unhygienic conditions. But Dharavi, in a way, is a kind of it's like a spontaneous kind of settlement in that sense. And few months back, I think last year or so, there was a state kind of report that the kind of the economic clout that place has in terms of what they produce and the goods and services they produce, if you look at that, that's quite substantial in that sense. So this is a productive kind of a place in that sense. But of course, these problems are all there.
The resources are much more in Dharavi compared to Valsava.
And that being almost like an international case study, a lot of NGOs and things like that, they're concentrating in quite a few foreign NGOs also, non-profits, they're also working here. And some enterprising people have started this, what do they call it? Slum tourism or something. Yeah. So they bring tourists and they take them around. I don't know, it's a very perverse thing to do in my opinion, but they do it all the same. So it's a different kind of thing, being in Bombay and being the focus of a lot of things, it is the same. Anubha, you want to say something?
More along the lines of what Sambudh was saying, that I also, while this is a nice research and nice study, and all of us know the effect of pandemic, which has come to slightly less privileged sections, especially for younger children, what is it that you're eventually trying to say? And you did say that you're trying to highlight it. Great. So it's been highlighted. And the other thing that you mentioned is that you would like certain other schemes which were rolled out pre-pandemic or otherwise to be kind of adopted. Sure. Some of them are already being done, primarily by NGOs. So I think yours seems more like a call to government to provide more resources or to concentrate on the plight of the children in these urban slums. While Dharavi is a great example, I would say even Bhalsawa is better placed than many rural schools. Right? So I think, yeah, it's a call to action for all of us. I do wish that, however, you had, I don't know, maybe suggested some rather concrete intervention, which is architects or space designers, maybe. I don't know if that is the mandate of the seminar or it's a freewheeling research, in which case that's fine. But I would have liked a slightly better kind of a call to action with some concrete recommendations. And while we are at it, do look at a couple of projects that are being done, one of them being done by one SPI only, the Mod School project on the Yamuna Pushta by Swati Janu, which you may have heard of. So she's been working on these kinds of things, which are completely dismantlable schools and all of that. And the Digital India Foundation by Osama, which basically sets out to bridge the digital divide. This is an issue more of bridging the digital divide in terms of education. And of course, the whole, you know, the nutrition and life space angle. It's all very valid. I can't fault the presentation or the research. I just, I'm still not very sure of what it aims to achieve, other than highlighting a fact.
Yeah, ma'am. I guess our primary aim was actually to throw some light on the issue, because even when we were researching, we went through all of the articles of the last 2 years of these famous news platforms, and there's literally one or two articles on the plight of children.
I am not too sure. You know, sometimes what happens with research is that when you start researching, and especially with internet or digital research, is that one link leads you to another. I do remember very distinctly, right at the beginning of the pandemic, when the lockdown happened, almost a year back, the first lockdown, there was a lot of hue and cry about what is going to happen to the children, especially children from less privileged backgrounds who do not have access to online education. There's a lot of material in that, even like I know about that, including the fact that we have been set back. I remember reading that we've been set back almost a decade in our midday meal and our girl child education scheme by the pandemic. So there is enough material out there. But yes, if you're going by the mainstream news media, the kind that you have on television, perhaps not there. But then I don't think that is a media worth even listening.
Ma'am, also when we started, we weren't looking at like concrete, maybe architecture interventions. But towards the end, we did find out, like we mentioned, Beta Bhalswa, where they actually architecture students and the graduates are doing projects over there, and like very simple hands-on, where in August of this year they had called for volunteers to help them build the playscapes for the children there, where like that can have a huge impact on their well-being, social and physical well-being. So I think that as architects, even we have a greater role that we can play than other than just highlighting for schemes. So I think that we kind of realized when we were wrapping up our study and looking for projects like that.
You know, one way out could have been, you know, I mean, if, suppose we for a moment, let's forget a conventional school, right? Suppose we have another model. You know, for example, this is a very interesting study done by some Indian researcher at MIT. What he had done was he had put in a TV monitor, a laptop monitor in one of the slum areas. And the what was coming on the screen was they're explaining the digestive system, for example, of human body. So this and there is no commentary or anything, because it was in English, those guys could not understand it. So this young children simply thronged around that TV, and they started and they're showing a bits of it every day. This, you know, this the clips of this film. So they figured it out, you know, they're showing that food going in your mouth and then it going to the thing and the stomach and all. They kind of figured out that what happens. So this is a way of, you know, I mean, it's not a classroom education, but it is something. It has a possibility. And if they do not have the resources to go to a school, or they don't have a space, then maybe there is another way of imparting some kind of basic education. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Just on a curiosity note, I just typed in Google, because I was just wondering when you say, I just typed digital divide in Indian schools. I have about 10 pages of results which are talking about the very thing that you're talking about. Right? So I suppose it's a matter of highlighting it. And it doesn't have to be an architectural intervention. It could simply be a poster campaign, an Instagram campaign, or anything, where it's a more call to action as the responsible young citizens of the country. What perhaps is lacking is that these reports, I'm just curious, because you said that it's a fact that not known. Yeah, you're right. It's probably not there on Instagram or YouTube or wherever. So maybe that could have been one of the things, that there is a dedicated Insta handle where you put out this issue on a daily basis. I mean, it doesn't need an architectural intervention always.
And eventually it is going to be a very robust IT system at the end of the day. You know, that will be the ruler. That will be ruling the whole thing. You know, without that, it's just not going to work anymore, it seems. Yeah. I mean, for example, all that offline, online education, and even, for example, what I mentioned, this kind of film they're showing. So this is largely dependent on IT.
Yeah.
And artificial intelligence and things like that. So probably, and this is probably cost effective. If somebody can really make it cheap, and maybe subsidize it from some side, so it'll bring out a difference definitely at some point. Thank you. Anything else coming up?
Thank you, sir and ma'am, for your insightful comments.
Well done. I say all congratulations. I say rather well done. I quite like it. As a reportage, as a
reportage. Yes.
Yes. Definitely. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir and ma'am, for your insightful comments and feedback. I would now like to invite Ayushi onto the stage. Over to you.
Thank you, Joanne. Just as the effect of the pandemic has impacted the busty severely, it has also witnessed the restricted use of public spaces worldwide. We would now like to begin our third session of the seminar, Public Places. The upcoming presentation focuses on the places that were used by people as an inevitable part of their life, but were completely shut down for months. We will look into what happened to the perception and the use of these spaces during the pandemic, how they were impacted, and how they will be perceived in the coming future. I now introduce the next group with their topic, the future of public spaces.
Good afternoon, everyone. Our seminar title is Public Spaces and Their Perception. Have these been permanently colored by the pandemic? We are a team of seven people, myself, Ishika, and with me, I have Akash, Chaitanya, Divyansh, Mohit, Ritvik, and Ritesh. We also express our humble gratitude towards our seminar guide, Architect Sandeep Kumar, for guiding us throughout our research. We have structured our presentation into four major sections. First is an introductory section about the public space and the onset of COVID. The second one, decoding the public space, is a detailed analysis of the same. The third section, the expedition information and the analysis, talks about a research methodology. And the last is the concluding section, actual present and the possible future. For the first time, the places which are the lifelines of the city have been impacted such that they showed no signs of life for months, an impact no one imagined. Here is a short motion graphics that will give us a brief background and the need to study this impact. Public spaces are at the heart of the urban city image, where most of the social sharing is experienced. Even Hannah Arendt, in her book, The Human Condition, argues about the importance of public spaces by stating that no human life, not even the life of the hermit in nature's wilderness, is possible without a world which directly or indirectly testifies to the presence of other human beings. This need for social interaction indeed requires a space, forming the utmost necessity for a public space. But the COVID-19, an unimaginable pandemic, not only locked us indoors, but also kept us away from the most important part of our cities. These spaces, the lifeline, the identity, the backbone of a city, were rendered completely lifeless by the virus. People either complied with the government-imposed restrictions or self-cautious measures and stayed indoors. One of the major impacts was witnessed in the social interaction between people. The virtual public spaces, such as meeting platforms, online recreational sites, emerged to be new mediums for interactions. A year later, the relief in the lockdown restrictions brought the masses back into these spaces and on streets, causing major changes in the perception and usage of these spaces. But one noticed that this pandemic left such an unprecedented impact on the minds of the people. The fear of getting exposed to other such outbreaks now lures over a million minds, and maybe will continue to. The longer the outbreak, the greater will be its impact on the future perception of public spaces. Unquestionably, the pandemic has pulled back the curtains on this inequitable feature of our cities and has forced us to reflect on a very important research question. How has the COVID-19 pandemic impacted the public spaces in Indian cities with respect to their perception and use? Further, we have structured our research into five major objectives: to understand the aftermath of the pandemic on the functionality of public spaces and to form a comparative analysis on the pre and the post notion of these spaces. Likewise, the aim is also to analyze the behavioral shift of users towards social interaction, if any, in these spaces through three methods: the activity mapping, time photography, and user interviews. Also, in order to apprehend the public response, it is crucial to identify and study the various forms of physical interventions which have already been made in and to these public spaces. This will lead to a detailed evaluation of the change in user density of these spaces post-pandemic, either due to government-imposed restrictions or self-cautious measures. Furthermore, the last intent of the research is also to identify the altered patterns, if any, and configurations of use of these public spaces. Moving on to the second section, decoding the public space. There is a hierarchical division of our subtopics to form a research framework. First, we will look into the key definitions of public space. The notion, form, and function of a public space has always been modified throughout history. Therefore, it becomes important to explore the concept of a public space, which we have used in our further research. The final definition thus is, a public space is described by the majority of users as easily accessible, open to all, and belongs to the public. It is in these spaces that the greatest of human interactions and relationships take place. For the purpose of our research, the four kind of public spaces chosen are parks, streets, marketplaces, and weekly markets. Now I request my colleague Divyansh to take us through the other parameters.
Thank you, Ishika. Social carrying capacity. Carrying capacity, being an objective measure, is same for everyone, whereas social carrying capacity involves environmental and human factors. A visitor's satisfaction and his or her intuitive sense of a special capacity makes social carrying capacity dependent on each individual. White proposed that everyone has an intuitive feeling of what too many appears, which is again a questionable parameter during the pandemic. User density. Previously, the social carrying capacity dealt with the upper limit of people in a place. User density deals with the actual number of users in a space at a given time. This is not dependent on one's perception, but is a parameter that is involved in determining the efficiency of public space. Clearly, optimum user density has been affected during the pandemic. Now I invite Chaitanya to continue.
Thank you, Divyansh. Moving on with the framework, social interaction is another important parameter that we identified while decoding public spaces, as it has a major contribution in the psychological and physical well-being of people. This is enabled in public spaces where people make new relations, participate in various sports, cultural, artistic activities, or to simply enjoy nature. But clearly, COVID-19 pandemic has dramatically changed the nature of our social interactions. Moving on to the last parameter, after the outbreak of COVID-19, it was certain to an extent that human perception towards the public spaces has changed. Humans are very social animals, and over time, the lack of social interaction is likely to erode our willingness to comply with lockdown and social distancing. Visiting public spaces in such times possesses some sort of risk. However, the willingness to take that risk is subjective and depends on various factors. Thus, risk-taking attitudes and human behavior is an important element to study. All these five parameters in the framework were put into an analysis matrix, which Akash will explain in the later of this seminar.
Thank you, Chinanya. So in the third section, we discuss the methods, data, and findings of the research. We divided our study into three major phases, including both research and analysis. The first phase was aimed towards preliminary data collection through activity mapping, pilot survey, full-scale survey, and user interviews. Through this data, we understood and established the change in perception of the users. In the second phase, we created a more detailed questionnaire from the previous data to understand the extent and the nature of the change, along with the future perception of these changes. After establishing the change and understanding the extent of the change, we move to the third phase, where we learn about the response of the users to the change through primary case studies and examples of the interventions. Now we move to the first phase, in which is the offline survey and interviews. To analyze the change in density during the pandemic in public spaces, we chose three sites around Delhi for conducting the interviews: Connaught Place, Moments Mall, and Pashchim Vihar District Park. The basis of choosing these sites were the diversity in type, scale, and accessibility. Also, the diversity in ownership makes them appropriate for the research. At Connaught Place, it was found that on the afternoon and the evening of the weekday, the density is very high at the place. And on the weekends, the density remains medium in the morning, increases during the afternoon, and continues to increase by the evening. While at the site of Moments Mall, the results were similar on weekdays and weekends. They both have medium density during late afternoon. Yeah, we also conducted a time photography exercise, which you can clearly see the change in the density and use during different times of the day. During the morning, the malls remain empty, while only in the afternoon people come to visit. This has resulted in shutting down of the shops due to no visitors. Finally, the third site was the Pashchim Vihar District Park. Similarly, at the park during the weekdays, the density is high in the afternoon. However, on the weekends, mornings and evenings, both have high density as people tend to visit more for recreation and fitness purposes. Overall, it was evident that these density mapping diagrams of three different public spaces that are very high density was observed in the park both during weekdays and weekends as compared to others. This indicated that the pandemic left such an impact on our minds that the longing for open green spaces has increased. On the contrary, the pseudo public spaces such as malls experienced less footfall overall. Similar results were observed in peer-reviewed article for the case studies of public and pseudo-public spaces done in Istanbul. Now I invite Ritvik to take us through the second phase, which is the online survey.
Thank you, Akash. The online survey was carried out into two different parts. First is the preliminary survey and second is the Delhi survey. In the preliminary survey,
Is this my network or?
Yeah. So in the preliminary survey, the aim was to understand the change in the public spaces. In this, we got responses from 111 participants whose answers helped us to study the change in these public spaces. Some questions were, do you agree that usage of public spaces has changed due to the risk factor? What change did you find in social interaction at public spaces during COVID-19? With the findings from the preliminary survey, a Delphi survey was then circulated with precise questions and objectives response that enabled the derivation of more quantitative results. The aim of this survey was to understand the extent and future perception of changes. We got responses from 51 participants that aided us to study the extent and nature of the changes along with the future relevance of public spaces. Now I invite Mohit to take us through the third phase of the research.
Thank you, Ritvik. Moving on to the third phase. In the third phase of the research, the derived observation from the above survey was further cross-referenced with the study of primary intervention made in and to the spaces by the authorities. What is intervention? In simple words, it's an act to prevent harm and improve function. So at the beginning of the pandemic, public spaces and streets were officially declared as risk zones, as they were the main hub for the social and economical engagement. Government and policymakers made few interventions to these public spaces. Talking about India, policymakers come out with some innovative and creative policies which change the whole definition of public spaces. First, starting with the temporary social distancing intervention. A temporary makeshift market, Raitu Bazaar, was set up at MCV ground, Vishakhapatnam, which shows the shift from the past, the way people use public spaces. Wearing masks, maintaining distance, marking areas to stand for a single person. Moving on to the medical aid intervention. The atrial and the core street function as a spine for emergency vehicle movement during the COVID lockdown. Many street and public spaces were converted to medical center and also temporary food distribution point. In the small scale design intervention, a case of designing of safe distancing using simple surface marking and signage has been demonstrated. Moving on to the city level design intervention, existing bike lanes have been widened and new ones were created to ensure safe distancing between cyclists. In the last tactical intervention, initiative like Break the Chain Umbrella project was initiated by Thanimukkam Gram Panchayat in Allapuza, which demonstrate a creative way of imparting social distancing just by using simple props. Now I request Ritesh to conclude the presentation.
Thank you, Mohit. Now on to the next topic of the actual present data and the conclusion for a possible future. We conducted two online surveys, a full-scale survey on the same lines of the pilot survey that we did earlier and a Delphi survey. The full-scale survey involved people of different age groups ranging from 15 to 55 years. The maximum responses came from the age group of 21 to 30 years. The full-scale survey addressed questions such as, what is a public space according to people? What are the changes that people have observed in these public spaces? Do they agree that there is a risk involved in visiting these public spaces? And what could be the reason that they will be willing to take such risks? The responses suggested that people perceive marketplaces, weekly markets, parks, shopping centers, and metro and bus stations as public spaces. More than 50% people agreed that the changes in public spaces have occurred in terms of interaction between people. It is very interesting to note that although 89.6% of people agree that there is a health risk in visiting public spaces, 65.7% are willing to take risks. And most of them gave mental and physical fitness, daily purchases, and medical emergencies as the reason that they will be willing to take such risks. Then we conducted a Delphi survey in order to generate a clear picture of what the perception of people is towards these public spaces. The questions of the Delphi survey was based on the results of the answer from the full-scale survey. It addressed questions about interaction between people, willingness to take risk, the nature and the extent of the changes in these public spaces. The results were segregated on the basis of age groups, and they suggested that the tendency to engage extensively with others in public spaces decreased. The results segregated on the basis decrease with the increase in age. Also, most of the people in the age group of 26 to 30 years and 16 to 20 years who are mostly working professional and high school or junior college students will choose online medium for social interaction. For the question about risk, people only agreed to take extensive risk for medical emergencies, while they agreed to take moderate risk for most of the activities. It is interesting to note that the age group of 16 to 20 and 26 to 30 years, who at large said that they would prefer online medium for social interaction, are not willing to take risk for recreation and social interactions. On a different note, people said that there is only a moderate change in the public spaces. Only the age group of 16 to 20 and 30 plus observed maximum changes in marketplaces. And only 30 plus year people observed maximum change in parks. Now, most of the people observed a neighborhood level change in these public spaces, where the age group of 16 to 20 observed a community level change in all public spaces except for weekly markets. Age group of 30 plus observed a city level change in marketplace. Now, to conclude our study and observation, the result of the study indicates that although in the initial phases of COVID-19 pandemic, the public spaces were forsaken, but things are starting to settle down and people do believe that the spaces will return to a certain point of normalcy. But we cannot rule out the impact of pandemic on the design and the planning of these public spaces. There is a shift towards planning a large number of small scale public spaces, and streets are likely to be redesigned, promoting more organized patterns. The emergence of virtual public spaces have affected the thought process of people, and they have started to move towards these virtual public spaces as opposed to actually visiting one. From the findings, it's apparent that the change exists, but the question that emerges is that will this change be permanent or will fade away with time? And if they will fade away, then how much time will it take to subdue the effects caused by the global pandemic? Thank you.
Thank you so much, team, for your presentation. Now I would like to invite the jury to share any feedbacks or comments that they may have, and for the audience to post any questions into the Q&A forum.
In fact, I would actually like the audience to, you know, I mean, it's just Sambuddha and I speaking, and except for one or two people, very little of the audience speaking. So I'll wait, in fact, this time for somebody from the audience to comment or question. I can see that we have 20 minutes devoted to it, but we don't get any questions. See, silence of the lambs.
So I think we'll have to fill in.
Yeah, we will, but I'm just curious why they will
I think they will come at the appointed time.
I think. So, so I thought that this was an interesting study because, yes, this is something that will definitely be impacted, has been impacted by the pandemic and will be. I mean, there are many, many interesting questions that this threw up. I personally would be very interested to see if the change is permanent or is it temporary? Will it fade and how it changes the nature of public space? I completely agree with the fact that a lot of open green spaces have seen a resurgence. I think one of the best things that has happened to Sundar Nursery is the pandemic, because I don't think it would have had so much of, eyeball attraction if it weren't for the pandemic. It would have taken much longer. But the way it has integrated, I mean, it was just almost timely the way that it was inaugurated and the pandemic struck. And then the way it has got integrated into the urban fabric of the city. Couple of reasons, of course, but the pandemic has played its part and that has lent. So I'll be very curious to see how it lasts, because just the past festive week has shown us that people tend to forget. And that's what the news and all of that would tell us. But there are certain things that people do remember. I would also be very curious, that's not really public space, but I would be very curious to see how this impacts the usage of public transport. I am told, and I read some places, that the metro, in fact, has the number of people using it has lessened a bit because of the enclosed nature of the metro travel. And that has actually kicked up the private vehicle ownership. including with a generation which was especially the under 30 years old people who were not like in Europe were not going for private vehicles because they felt that they could do an Uber or a metro. I think that trend may have been reversed. Now that's not really related to public space, but it's a trend in lifestyle and how it has been reserved. It would be also very interesting to see how this whole notion of going out in the evening, whether it's to a food court or something, has reversed. But public places, if I'm just limiting them to markets and certain green spaces, yes, of course, the trend is reversed. And I found it very interesting, the study. And I would be very, very curious to see if you follow it through maybe in another 6 months and then maybe in another year to see how it goes. That's actually all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Anubha. I think it's an excellently conducted thing, the inquiry, so to speak.
Yeah.
But I think what I kind of miss is that, you know, you have defined the survey very well, how you're going to do it, you know, the methodology of it and all that is very, very, I mean, most of the time you have devoted, most of the time that when you spoke, was devoted to how the survey was conducted, right? And various surveys that you do. But I think conclusion part could have been a little more extended. I think you should have cut more on the that part, because you're describing the survey process. That's fine. I mean, that's all right. But I think I was looking for more conclusions, for example. I mean, I would have liked to see what actually you derive from here, some practical examples, for example. And the other thing is that when you say public space, which are the public spaces? Let's talk about it for a minute. What are the public spaces? How do you define a public space? You have given us a classical definition right in the beginning. No problem on that. But in the Indian context, let's put it this way. I mean, a public space in Italy is completely different from a public space in India. There, you know, the town square is the main thing. Everybody comes there. Somebody brings his girlfriend and Ferrari, and then everybody admires it and all that. Then have a bit of wine sitting next to the fountain and things like that. And it's a completely different kind of atmosphere. But here we have a very chaotic public spaces. I mean, I'm not talking of something like Sundar Nursery or something, which is very nicely done and all that. And as Anubha has rightly pointed out, this is one of the highlights of Delhi that has happened in last couple of years. It's a wonderful place to visit. But other places, what are the other places? For example, a place of religious worship.
Yeah.
I
was about to say the Hanuman temple in Kanauji.
Hanuman temple, like things like that. You know, people, it's a throng. Do they go there anymore? Or for example, Nizamuddin Awliya or any other place for that matter, you know, where large number of people are going, and what has happened there? Do people still, these are the main public spaces in our life. Yeah. Connaught Place is fine. Connaught Place is largely because of the increased footfall, because of the metro and all that. And it has suddenly become very popular because of large number of people pass through that space and all that. I don't know. A month and a half back, I was traveling and I saw a lot of people there. Still, I mean, even after COVID, a lot of people are hanging around there. They'd opened up shops and all that. So, but what actually is then is the marketplace. What are you talking about? Is it a mall or is it an open bazaar or is it a high street shopping? What exactly are you talking about and what do we do there? This interests me a lot.
Just to add to that, if I may, there are different sort of demographic twists to it also. Like, again, sorry, I keep bringing up the South Delhi example, but that's what I see on my everyday life. Like M Block Market in GK1, which used to be a very, very crowded place. Other than shopping, it was also a place where people just went and hung out or, you know, just roamed around. It's quite abandoned for the last 2 years.
Disaster.
And it hasn't picked up. On the other hand, if I go to Kalkaji,
yes, that has become very thriving.
It is as crowded as it was. So how does the demography also play a part? Does your economic and other kind of criteria then, How does that impact your use of public space or the lack of it or whatever? So the economics of the people who are using it is also something that we could examine in this.
And you see, the
I could just come in for a minute. Hi, Arupa.
Yeah, Sadeep. How are you?
Hi, very well.
Good to see you, yeah.
Was exactly what we had discussed with them, that, you know, public spaces, you either go out of choice or out of compulsion.
Hmm.
You know, so there are, you know, for example, a street in a low-income group housing would be the only way to access a workplace, for example. And so it's not a choice for you to access or not to access that other public space.
True.
You know, you will do it. So your risk assessment to access the public space will be very, very different as against, let's say, a mall, which is exactly what Anubha is talking about in terms of the demographics of the economic or the socio-cultural profile of people. But this group, in fact, chose a limited, or they wanted to scope down public spaces to a specific kind. I think, Akash, would you want to clarify there?
Yeah, absolutely, sir. So that we could actually focus on some a kind of public spaces to come up with a result and conclusion. We kind of scoped down to some of the
What was the kind of public space that you narrowed down? I mean, so, I can't say that it's commercial because you do Connaught Place, you do the mall, but you also do the Paschim Park, Paschim Nagar Park. So
what we basically scoped down on was that those public spaces where people voluntarily choose to go or choose not to go, like in malls, basically they can, if they want to go, they can go. And if they want to avoid, they can avoid them. Same as for the parks. If they want to go, they can go or they can avoid them. So that's how we basically scoped down. So that's why we also not did the transit oriented spaces, because that became a compulsion that if they have to go somewhere, they had to take transit.
But or public transport. A very interesting example would have been the religious places. I mean, it is a compulsion, ma'am. And yet it is not a compulsion.
Yes, of course, ma'am.
So these, you know, because I'm saying this because this is so integral to our daily life. The reason, you know, as our concept of Sandeep was saying, to go or not to go is a question. Now the thing is, go to the local market. It's not as if I'm trying to interact with somebody there or have a great social life. Maybe by chance I meet a neighbor or something, say hello to him and things like that. But I'm going for to purchase a few essentials from the market. So our interaction with I think public spaces, so to speak, public spaces are quite different from what other people see. I mean, nobody. It's not like Central Park or, you know, somebody's jogging, somebody's doing something or something, all kinds of things. And similarly, the European open spaces that we talk about, ours is much more kind of heterogeneous. I think the finest example of this is the Nehru Place space, the Nehru Place courtyards. It is an amazing the way it transforms. I think just as when you're more free, and things sort of calm down, go to Nehru Place one day and see how, you must have been there a number of times to get your computer stuff and all that. See how that place transforms. It's amazing the way, and interestingly enough, you know, as winter approaches, the market moves more towards the sun. Where there's this one particular stretch of the Nehru Place which receives a lot of sun. So there people, you'll find people have set up shops on that stretch. So things like that, you know, and then different kinds of markets that open up, old clothes, new clothes, the computer parts, all kinds of things. So that's and the interaction that place is very, very intense, because the kind of number of people, and there is no, I mean, I had to go there for some urgent work. I was not willing to go, but I had to go. And it is like any other day. I mean, these people are not staying away from that market. So that is also true, you know, this intense use of spaces. And this is not something you'll find elsewhere. I think this is completely different from other countries, for example, other cultures.
So interestingly, Sandy, on the demographic bit, I did bring up the GK1 M Block market, which is a higher economic demographic and which I find quite forlorn after the pandemic. But the same economic group, so the need for public space is there in Khan Market,
yes,
which is bustling.
It's bustling.
It's not that people of a certain economic background are not visiting markets at all. Khan Market is almost, it's not as crowded as it used to be, but it is quite busy.
Yeah, 80% to hai hai.
It's not busy. But the MROC market in GK1 has taken a hit. So that might be an interesting study why that has taken a hit. While Khan Market, which is as expensive, if not more expensive, is actually doing very well. So what is the nature of the public space which has survived and which will probably...
I think one fact that comes to mind is the visibility. I think the tremendous visibility Khan Market has, that you can actually walk through right next to the shops, and you may not buy anything, or you can also drive through the outer road and see the glitter of
It may also be the mix of shops.
Mix is very important. Yes, that's right.
There was one more point that we discussed with the students.
Yeah.
I was giving them an example that, in one of my walks around my house during the lockdown, while the marketplace, the local market, was completely devoid of people, I chose to walk through a small urban village.
Okay.
And the streets there were just about 4 feet wide in places. And those streets, by virtue of their scale, were really extensions of their living rooms almost.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So there were people there sitting and talking, there were kids playing, and life was just gung-ho completely as if nothing had happened.
That's right.
The minute that scale changes,
where
enforcement comes in, a certain degree of formality comes in, then they are completely devoid of people.
True.
It's really layered, how you interpret exactly.
And we appropriate public space at our will. I mean, like you were saying, you take your charpoy out and sit with your grandchildren there, and somebody is cooking something in the corner, or neighbor is walking by and all that. So this is something very, very, very different from what you see elsewhere.
Absolutely.
I think one distinction that would be interesting to keep in mind is to take out the retail public space out of it and look at the non-retail public space, because that is something which is more willful. Retail comes with its own compulsion, but how is the non-retail space? And there the Nizamuddin, Hanuman Mandir, Delhi Heart, which is kind of retail but not quite, or the other kind of urban precincts or whatever these are, the parks, the how are the non-retail spaces?
The Saket Mall, because it has that outer arcade and the large courtyard, it's much more successful than any other mall that you have, It's largely because of that huge open space that you have, and a lot of things happen there. So it is again regenerated, kind of the DLF Mall and all that. But same thing has not happened to other large malls. But this has definitely kind of regenerated. Saket Mall, nahi recently gaya wo apadar. It's not as crowded, but I was just passed by. I was afraid to go in. But generally speaking, they're trying to sort of make it more open in that sense.
Yeah. Just one last point, Sandy, and if the group wishes to take it forward, is that one marketplace, so to say, which was anyways declining for whatever reason, I don't think I have any reason or conclusive reason, was the Basant Lok Market.
Okay.
It used to be very, very vibrant at one point, and then suddenly it went boom. I mean, I would be very interested to see what has happened to it after the pandemic. I think that market is dead, but it was dying before the pandemic, and now it's well and truly probably dead. So that would be for somebody, if any urban design studio is interested in taking it up and figuring it out what happened to Basant Lok Market, which had everything going for it, and one day it just went boom. So that would be an interesting study.
That was quite mysterious, in fact.
Very mysterious.
Very mysterious.
I don't know. So that's why I'm saying it's an urban design studio waiting to be done.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sandeep, I think it's a good job. It was a nice, interesting seminar. Good
work.
Congratulations to all of
you.
Good job.
I'm also very curious, Ranna ma'am, to see that all of them decide to do the same background, which happened with the previous.
I was wondering, what is this art gallery is?
And the white shirts, don't miss that, ma'am.
Okay.
They're all in the same virtual public space.
The group also had the same background.
Yeah,
yeah. So they're both coordinated. Very good.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And I just a small story to relate. I love this story. Last year we were in thesis jury, SPA thesis, final thesis. This one chap, I forget his name now. He was located in Bihar, Gaya. He was in Gaya district and in a small small town somewhere. So while the jury was in progress, we lost touch. Internet was not working properly. Okay, so he was hugely kind of embarrassed and kind of shaken up. We said, "Don't worry, you take your time and re-establish the contact." So what he did was he went outside. So there's a lane outside. He's going to a very narrow lane. He took his laptop and sat there. And believe me, the we forgot about the presentation and what was happening in the lane. You know, it was a running, you know, the magic show, circus. You know, they say one beggar was going, "Allah ke naam de de, uske Bhagwan ke naam pe de de." He just passed by, had a look at his computer, then went away. Some kid came, say, "Bhaiya, kya kar rahe ho?" And you know, this we could see the whole thing that was happening. So this is what public life is all about. I said, "Yeah, tu jaldi jaldi kar." But he was able to establish contact and explain. So it was so interesting to see what happens in our the towns. Okay, thank you. Anubha, or kuch?
Thank you. Good job.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for the comments. The last group has given us some insight into public spaces. Now let us zoom into one such public space, shopping malls. The upcoming presentation focuses on decreasing footfall of shopping malls and how they can repurpose themselves to survive the pandemic. I'd like to introduce the next group with their topic, shopping malls shaping up to survive.
Thank you so much, Tilak. Good evening to one and all. My name is Joanne, and I'd like to present my teammates as well, Sanavan Nahid, Avni Gupta, Ishika Saravgi, M.S. Shivakrishnan, and Sahiba Sukur. We are led by guides Professor Dr. Anjana Mittal and architect Priyanka Kochar. Today, we'd be proud to present to you our research topic on repurposing retail architecture through the lens of the COVID-19 pandemic. I'd now like to hand over the stage to Sanavar to give us a background to our study. Over to you, Sanavar.
Thank you, Joanne. So as we all know, the onset of COVID-19 pandemic was highly unprecedented event for which even the best designed buildings were not prepared. The retail architecture or shopping malls, as we all know, has taken a huge hit environmentally as well as functionally. Therefore, we arrive at a research question is, in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic, what are the most feasible steps that existing as well as future shopping malls can take to improve their footfall? Proceeding further, the aim of research is twofold. First, to arrive at a feasible long-term solution that shopping malls are trying to survive the pandemic by examining various factors and that leads to the current footfall. Second aspect is that the status of shopping mall typology in the COVID-19 scenario and the long-term solution and the changes that are required in order to keep the buildings moving further. So we have the outline of objectives. First, we start by forming a basis for the repurposing of building through literature review and online surveys. Then we proceed on to studying various strategies used by interviews and case studies. Then we would, according to these, we arrive at an analysis and advisory. Now I would like Sahiba to proceed further.
Thank you, Sanava. I will now explain what we learned from the literature study. So firstly, we'll go through some factors that affected the footfall of malls in the onset of pandemic. Some of them were government regulations like lockdowns, which restricted the movement of people, a hesitation to go out for non-essential purposes due to a newfound fear of public places. And people started going to convenience stores close to their home for essential commodities purchase. Study also showed that people were being wary of using public transportation and more switched to private vehicles, which affected footfall of malls, which were located further away from residential areas and where customers were dependent on public transport. It was also observed that people found online shopping more convenient during the pandemic, and the already booming e-commerce market further impacted footfall of malls and shopping centers. Many shopping malls have a closed air conditioning system with little or no natural ventilation, increasing the risk of spreading the airborne COVID-19 virus. Moving on, we identified some trends which took place during the pandemic, which was mainly malls opting for digital and contactless shopping experiences like cashless payments or curbside pickups. And despite all the negative impacts, it was found that the number of shops that actually closed down was still very small, as most brands could sustain some losses. And only in few cases have the owners completely shut down their businesses. Most opened up back as soon as government regulations eased. As shops slowly opened back up, people also slowly trickled back outside and footfall into malls increased gradually. As malls have turned out to be the only source of public space for social interaction in most places in India. The table on the right was in response to the question, how much do you see yourself spending on essential or non-essential items over the next 4 weeks compared to the last 4 weeks? And the data collected showed that the net spending intent for non-essential items was far less as opposed to essentials like groceries, medicine, utilities, etc. Next, Shivakrishnan will be explaining further about the online surveys we conducted.
Thank you, Saiba. So the online survey was conducted to understand the effects the pandemic had on shopping malls. Out of the response recorded from various age groups, majority of the respondents were between 21 to 30 years of age, and most of them didn't have any mixed-use malls in their city. The next slide shows the respondent demographic for the survey. As you can see, 89% of the response came from India, and 11% came from the Middle East. This include instances where the respondents have multiple malls in their vicinity and instances where they have to travel considerable distances to reach the malls. Most of the respondents prefer using private transport to access these spaces, as this would ensure there was less chance to come in contact with the virus. Furthermore, in some instances, the malls themselves became travel destinations of leisure, and people normally preferred using private transport in such cases. We can see in the next slide that even though pandemic introduced many health risks when it came to traveling, 60% of the respondents still visited malls during this time. However, their frequency of visit changed from a majority who visited such places once or a few times per month, shifting to just a few times per year. As we move on, we can see the reason for this is the fact that even though malls provide social spaces, when it comes to shopping, people prefer online vendors, especially for clothing and non-essential purchases. However, majority of the shops cope with this shift using various strategies like introducing online services and takeouts or joining with online retailers to sell their products in their platform. Now, when it comes to social distancing norms, a majority of malls followed prevention strategies as per the government, some of which had direct impact on sales, like 50% of shops remaining closed, reduced staff capacity, provision of trial rooms no longer being available, etc. As we can see from the next slide, this has led to some spaces being used less frequently when compared to pre-pandemic situations. At the same time, spaces like gaming zones and outdoor hangout spaces have experienced a rise in usage, as these spaces had comparatively lower footfall in pre-pandemic situations, and also because COVID-19 has made a shift in footfall in favor of social spaces. Now, I invite Avani to take over and explain the tenant survey.
Thank you, Shiva, for handing the word to me. So the main idea of doing different surveys was to get a general data of different aspects related to retail mall before and after the pandemic. So this is the primary tenant survey for Ambience Mall that is located in Vasant Kunj, New Delhi. So we did the survey to understand the effect of pandemic on sales, employment and customer behavior in shopping centers, but from the point of view of the employees and the owners of the store. So as per the records, out of all, 90% of the respondents either work in or own a non-essential shop. Next, we start with learning the number of employees that work in each of these different retail stores. And we got to know that 6 out of 10 respondents had more than 5 employees, while the rest had 5 or fewer working with them. As we move on, we try to get a rough idea of the number of people visiting the mall before and after COVID, which help us examine the footfall of the mall on how frequently are they still useful to the general crowd. So as per the records, the footfall of the individuals has decreased drastically, with some stores experiencing a decrease of around 76%, which greatly affects the sales as well. As we move on, due to COVID, numerous norms and restrictions were released. So hence, we tried to find out whether the shops within the malls were actually accessible to people or not. We basically tried to find what the real reason is if the footfall had decreased so much, was it the COVID norms or was it the people not feeling safe visiting the malls anymore? So as per the records, 80% of the stores, mostly the non-essential ones, were closed. That too for 5 to 7 months on an average. Next, we surveyed the employees and their pays during the pandemic. As the responses reflect, about 50% of the employees were not given their salary at all, while the rest has to satisfy with a pay cut that goes up to 40 to 50% in some cases, as shown in the bar graph on the right. It is interesting to know that the reasoning given to them was for the pay cut was to preserve the stores for a fast recovery, as at that time the stores were not able to generate enough revenue. As we move on, we find out that COVID has not only let employees be satisfied with the pay cut, but there are some who had lost their jobs. As per the record, 60% of the respondents confirmed that people were unemployed from their jobs. As we move on, due to COVID restrictions and people hesitation in visiting the mall, which mainly summarized the health issues, the sales in the stores have decreased drastically, and so had the face-to-face services in the stores. As we can see in the bar graph on the right, the sales have decreased to 90 to 100% in some cases. Also, as noticed by employees, there were some brands that have shut down their outlets in various locations. Some of these include some well-known brands, namely Miniso, Zara, and Nestle. Others mentioned some locally owned stores and cafes that were shut down due to the losses, as they did not have money to pay their employees and keep their business running. So we can say that the COVID norms and restrictions were not only the reason for the shutdown of these stores, but because these stores were not able to generate enough revenue to keep them going, these were shut. In the last, we asked the employees about some of the changes that they've experienced post the lockdown. So as mentioned by them, some of them believe that the face-to-face services in the stores have decreased so much and the online business has boomed. Also, various safety measures have been adopted by the restaurants and the cafes as per the government norms. And due to the losses experienced by the stores and the owners, many had lost their jobs and had to go through tough times. So basically, all the questions that we have asked them were related to each other, as in due to the lockdown and threat of spread of the disease, public spaces like shopping centers have experienced drastic decrease in footfall that further results in cutting down the labor cost or even shutdown of various stores as they were unable to run their businesses. Further, for better understanding, we did a primary case study of Oasis Mall in Dubai and interviewed the management, about which Duran will be explaining further.
Thank you, Avni. As she explained, a major factor of the ambient mall's lack of footfall and performance was the lockdown restrictions imposed by the Indian government. But what if a mall did not face such external hurdles? What opportunities would it then have to improve its footfall? We selected one such mall free of such restrictions, the Oasis Mall in Dubai. Through an interview with the management, we gained an expert's perspective on the strategies that shopping malls can adopt. To give it some background, Oasis Mall faced many challenges even before the pandemic. It was uncommonly small for a mall in Dubai, having a built-up area of only 60,000 square meters. In addition to that, it was also unfortunately located near two mega malls, which made it impossible for it to compete as their equal. Moreover, the radial planning of the spaces around the atrium reduced the visibility of the retail outlets, which affected the footfall into those spaces. Lastly, the lack of open spaces in the mall did not help with the natural ventilation, and retrofitting existing HVAC systems is both expensive and extremely unfeasible. Therefore, the mall needed to repurpose itself far before the pandemic onset. It established its identity as a community mall, which focused on essential services such as repair services of watches, shoes, electronics, etc., grooming of both people and pets, as well as passport services. Basically, these were all services that required face-to-face interaction and could not be replaced by online services. They also focused on social leisure spaces such as kids' entertainment facilities, food court, and Ayurvedic spas. After the pandemic, the Oasis Mall turned to mixed-use strategies to keep the footfall alive. For one, the back of the retail stores that were receiving little or no footfall due to the pandemic was going to waste. These newly vacated areas were then converted to small offices to bring in new footfall and revenue. In addition to that, there was also a new typology added recently in the form of a ballet school, attracting more customers. Lastly, technological innovations were used, such as the online curbside pickup, which in retail, and kiosks are the storefront of these retail spaces where items can be chosen to enhance customer experience without adding to the risk. As you can see, all these steps have proved successful. Retail, once the highest sector, has reduced from 75% to 60% of the total area, while F&B and entertainment and other such social facilities have increased, in fact, from 25 to 40%. The additional 15% of essential services has also helped bring in the footfall to pre-pandemic rates to about 14,000 heads per day. And the percentage of customers who achieve their purpose of visiting the mall, also known as conversion rates, have returned to 40 to 50%. So in the end, what can malls of today and the future do? We learned that there's a steady shift from retail to social spaces. More and more services that cannot be easily replaced or replaced at all by e-commerce are contributing positively to the mall performance, including essential services and social spaces as well. Technological innovations too can be used to improve mall experience and to their advantage without adding to the risk of spreading the virus. We also observed that mixed use, when used wisely and at a suitable scale, can actually attract a wider range of customers. While most malls in Dubai, being tourism-oriented destination malls, used a hotel typology, Oasis Mall understood that its target user group as the community and used offices and a small studio instead. Lastly, the improvement of ventilation systems is something only feasible in the early design stage. Thus, it is something that future malls can incorporate instead of in the existing ones. We would now like to conclude with a quote by Lord Norman Foster. As an architect, you design for the present with an awareness of the past and for a future which is essentially unknown. And with mall design as we know it, rapidly changing in today's pandemic climate, this statement could not be more true. Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury members to share their comments and feedback, and the audience to post any question answer in the question answer forum or the chat box.
Anubha, I just have a few things to say. One is, should you not have discussed the nature of mall typology at some point? What a mall is like? I don't know. I've never been to a mall. Tell me, what is a mall? How is it different from high street shopping? How is it different from market? I don't get any feel of that. I mean, there are various types of typologies, right, for malls. The most popular one is that you have a central atrium, and then you have shops on either side, but there are a whole lot of other things, others as well. So if that was discussed, it would have been it would have made it clear. I mean, it's fine. You're saying that you're repurposing mall, the one in Dubai, and then it is doing well. That's fine. But I think it doesn't make a point in related to what the purpose of this seminar is. Somehow it is detached from what we are discussing. That's my feeling. Okay. And for example, this is probably one of the most maligned building typologies, malls. People hate it for different reasons. Some say it is this and some say that, the air quality is bad, it shows off, and things are expensive and all sorts of things. But if you had explained this a bit, that what exactly is a, how is it, what is it derived from? I mean, what does it get its ideas from? How did it develop? Some idea of that, you should have rooted it in your subject. For example, all the modern old malls, shopping centers, shopping bazaars in Middle East, they're the precursors of malls. Bazaar in Isfahan or in Istanbul, you name it, and they're all, or in Aleppo in Syria, all of them are based on the same idea that you have street shops on either side, you have skylit domes on top, and then you have a whole lot of things happening. And so that if you had established the genealogy of malls, it would have been much more interesting. So to establish why people love it to hate it, or hate it to love it, then okay, sorry. Anubha, aap bataye. And it doesn't make a point, I'm sorry to say, but at the end of the day, I don't think, what is the point that you're trying to make? That they should be repurposed, is it? That's the thing you want to say?
Sir, if I may.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yes, yes.
So the type of shopping malls which we are referring to are like the ones that we normally come across, the ones with more often than not the central atrium and various retail spaces and perhaps like some social and leisure spaces as well, like the ones that you find in metropolitan cities.
Yeah.
I agree that we had covered two case studies, and one was in the Middle East, and the other one, which is the tenant survey, we had actually done in Vasant Kunj, which was the survey on the tenants. We actually did that to achieve a sort of a balance and compare the two malls and see what are the different obstacles they face.
So, I never get the feel. I never got to see what the Vasant Kunj mall has to offer. I mean, I saw the plans of your Dubai mall, but I didn't get an idea of what the other mall you're talking about. You know, it's probably, I mean, probably you've done a tenant survey and all that, but the plan, it's not clear what exactly it is all about.
Yes.
Sorry, continue. I interrupted you, John. Go ahead, please.
Yes, sir. On that point, I do agree, because the Vasant Kunj mall, it was mainly, we did that as in the form of a tenant survey, more than an actual site study, which is to see what problems they were facing. And actually the point we want to make through that was, in the case of Indian malls, the problem they were facing and the obstacles to footfall they were facing was largely due to the government restrictions that are imposed on Indian malls. Whereas we actually used the one in Dubai because that did not have those kind of restrictions, and we want to explore what the opportunities that it could have to actually do the repurposing once an external interference like government restrictions have been lifted.
Okay. I believe you.
I actually found it quite interesting, because I did see two very conclusive, and I've actually noted them down because I hadn't thought of malls like that. Two very conclusive kind of recommendations. One is that you are shifting, you're recommending a shift of a mall from a retail space to a social space. And the second thing that you said is that to incorporate services that cannot be offered online. Because your research kind of pointed out that anything that could be done online has been done online, including in India and even in your tenant survey. So I found that there you had two very solid conclusions, actually quite refreshing. One of the things, however, which I wanted to question was that you mentioned early on in your presentation that malls are the only source of social interaction. Now, that is a little bit of a generalized, simplistic statement, because maybe for a particular, again, a group of people, they may be, but I wouldn't make a statement as strong as saying that malls are the only source of social interaction where. I mean, either you tell me where and amongst which demographic. But so that's a slightly controversial statement for me. The other thing which was a conflicting, actually, conclusion in your research, everybody has switched off their videos. I'm looking at a lot of IJASFA. Please, some videos to be switched off. So the other thing that I noticed, which you mentioned, was that which was a conflict, was that some people said that, I mean, in your research, you earlier said that most of the shops have reopened, but then somewhere later on the research, it was mentioned that 50% of the shops have shut. So that, I was a little confused there. But other than that, I was quite okay, because I thought your two conclusions were very, very solid. And...
ma'am, if I could answer...
But please.
Yes, actually, so in answer to that controversial statement about malls being the only source of entertainment to the people, actually, I'm surprised it hadn't been mentioned, because that actually referred to a demographic. So the malls, it is actually in India that the mall is often, more often than not, the only source or the main source of social interaction, because unlike in developed countries where there are also outdoor facilities as well, malls are often, more often than not, the only source of social interaction, and thus it is comparatively more irreplaceable, at least in India. And this was actually something that I'd found sourced from a few experts who had said that. They had actually claimed that that was the reason why malls and are losing very few shops and very few retail spaces are being shut down.
I'm afraid I will not agree with that, because that statement, again, as I say, it's simplistic. They are not the only places for social interaction. They may be for a particular, maybe for a particular city or a particular group of people, but not. As Sandeep just said a little while back, if you go to a urban village or a slightly denser community, you will find that the streets outside the house are also places for social interaction. If you go to, even in a city as highly planned as Chandigarh, if you go to the community sector parks, especially in the older sectors like 21 and 22, which are the lower economic group where the LIG housing is, you'll find that those parks are densely populated by all sorts of things, people doing yoga, laughing clubs and all of that. So I think that that statement, I wouldn't make it as it applies to all statement. And secondly, when the shops reopening, it's not because that is the only place that they have and they are very happy with it. Most of the shops in a mall are highly branded shops, whether it is Reebok or whether it is a Marks and Spencer or whatever, and they have terribly deep pockets. And I know that from my work in the retail environments that they don't make their sales in malls. And this is an acknowledged fact in the retail industry. They don't make much money from their stores in the malls. This is for prominence and for visibility. Do you know what is the highest, how Reebok and Adidas and all of those brands in India get their revenue? They get it from those factory outlets. That is the highest source of their revenue in India. And this is a documented fact. Their stores in the mall are just to create a brand visibility, a brand proposition and aspiration. So people will go to the mall, look at a Reebok store, and they will see a pair of shoes, which is 6,000 rupees. And then they'll go to the factory outlet where they'll get the same shoe for 4,000 rupees. And that is a documented fact. The most of the sales for all brands in India, most of these sort of high-end brands happen through their so-called factory outlets. In any city, you will see, in Delhi, it is along that Sarata Vihar road. It is on the Bairoli Gurgaon road. And I'm sure in other places as well. And there you will find these factory outlets. So the shops in the malls for big brands are more of advertisement than actual sales. So that's why they will never shut them, because they never anyways generated revenue out of those stores. Okay. So that was that I kind of knew as a fact till about 5 years back. I don't have the latest research, but this was a documented research at that point. So the shops reopened because, and on the other hand, the few shops that shut may have been the ones who actually depended on the revenues from the mall, which they lost. So you will find the local brands or the what we call the mom and pop stores or the local stores which would have shut, because they would not have been able to match the deep pockets of a Reebok or a Marks and Spencer or whatever it is. So that I would expect a little bit more nuanced research into. And that statement that malls are the only source of social interaction, big question mark. However, I do like your two conclusions that the recommendations that you shift from a retail to social space, very important, and services that cannot be used, that cannot be provided unless they are accessed face-to-face. That seems to be a no-brainer. So nicely done on that account. Thank you.
Thank you.
There is a question. Oh no, that's the previous one.
Yes, ma'am, that's from last time. Thank you, sir, and thank you, ma'am, for your comments. We'd like to introduce the next group now. Just like the malls, we also have weekly bazaars in our cities. And one of the worst affected due to COVID pandemic are the temporary shop owners who did not have fixed income sources even before the pandemic. We welcome the next group to share their study on the Hafta Bazaars, soul of the city.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, everyone. I'm Kamal Kaushal Mawari. Let me introduce my team members, Femi Susan Reggie, Shivani Yadav, Shonit Jain, Kankya Shilpi Kachap, and Azharuddin. With Professor and architect Arpita Dayal as our guide, we would like to present our research paper on temporality of Aftabazaar. Things are generally defined on the basis of how they are perceived by the definer. In that way, spaces are defined according to the needs of the people. As needs change with time, so does perception, so does the definition of spaces. As perceptions predominantly change with time, given the knowledge accumulated in various factors, it is advisable to say that spaces are defined temporally. City, when perceived as a space, more than a fixed attributes, what makes a city space are the relationships between them. Because a city by nature is temporal, and we must address its many aspects of temporality in order to comprehend them. I would like to shed light on a quote which thrived us to frame our research and consequently our research question. Quote, rather than a static understanding of space from a single perspective or an abstract understanding of time, we need to be able to draw different perspectives and combine understanding of time and space together. One such case of temporary urbanism is the urban market, concurrence of formal and informal spaces in the same public realm. Here, the formal spaces are understood as the built permanent static environment that is surrounded by the informal kinetic spaces in such a way that their coexistence gives rise to a unique kind of urbanism. Aftabazaars have various contradictory notions associated with them. There are both positive and negative perceptions about the Aftabazaar, as well as the challenges that these markets confront, eviction in this case, as a result of these perceptions. In the light of this ongoing pandemic, such challenges have been amplified and hindered the temporal stability of these markets. Therefore, the need of the study, the various challenges concerning these temporal spaces, especially spaces like Aftabazaars, which have the historical and cultural significance in these urban contexts, and the changes they have incurred in the response to ongoing pandemic, is of utmost importance. So our research question is, how do changing circumstances due to pandemic affect the Aftabazaars, and what role does its temporality play in adapting to these changes? The objects of our analysis are as follows. Plurality, understanding the play of temporality, which will later be elaborated in how we proceeded. Consequently, how temporality acts to the identity or the importance of the bazaar. Third being the examining the bazaar during and after the pandemic outbreak. Further, I call upon Shonit to brief about the methodology we followed in the aspect of the study.
Thank you, Kamal. So I'll be discussing the methodology we followed to carry out the study. So the very first process was the literature review. We initiated the study with literature review to get a basic understanding of terms like Aftabazaars, temporary, transience, permanence, and aspects of temporality. The next step was to relate these aspects of temporality with the framework of a weekly market to understand the degree of its temporality. The next step was to conduct a primary case study. So after analyzing the secondary data, we conducted a primary case study. This step was most crucial for our study as we analyzed the temporality of the weekly market. We analyzed the secondary data with respect to the findings from our primary site visit. Further, we tried to relate these particular aspects of temporality to the findings of our primary case study report. The third step was the personal interviews. So these personal interviews, they gave us a better insight about the problems and conditions of vendors during the pandemic, how they had coped during the lockdown, and what is their current situation. These vendors also provide a detailed information about the basic functioning and framework of the market. The next step was the online surveys. So online surveys were conducted to understand the consumer mindset, whether people are still willing to go to such markets or not, and if so, what are the reasons behind their visits. Next, moving ahead, based on our understanding of the literature review, we have identified certain aspects of temporality which render a space temporal qualities. Applying these aspects of temporality to the framework of Aftabazaar forms the basis of our study. So starting with the first aspect of temporality is connectivity. Aftabazaars have traditionally appeared in close proximity to prominent areas like monuments, villages, or transportation nodes. And they serve as intermediary node between these more notable nodes of the city.
You'll have to move your slide a little up. I can't see. Or is that half? Is that circle half on the slide?
Yes, ma'am. The circle is half.
It's an animation. So as I go on, the aspects will come along. So yeah.
No, the circle is itself half, ma'am.
Yeah, that's by design.
Half, ma'am. Yeah, circle is half. So yeah, moving ahead. So next aspect of temporality is heterogeneity. Heterogeneity in Hafta Bazaar can be observed in terms of space utilization, merchandise, and the socio-economic backgrounds of both consumers and retailers. It generates many contrasting necessary components which adds to the character of the market. The next aspect of temporality is multiplicity. Coexistence of multiple elements which could be complementary or contradictory to each other. The elements owed to heterogeneous nature of the Hafta Bazaar. Moving forward, the next aspect of temporality is rupture. So the temporariness of these bazaars, with them being set up and dismantled at the same time every week, represents a certain quote-unquote deterritorialization and re-territorialization. The very quote-unquote deterritorialization and re-territorialization is what adds to the quote-unquote patina of life at the city level. The last aspect of temporality is perception paradox. So perceptions of any location in this example, the Hafta Bazaar, that are both temporal and subjective in character. And the effect of these perceptions on the operation and structures of Hafta Bazaars, how the view of a specific group of individuals may be favorable to the functioning of a bazaar, and some views such as Hafta Bazaars being a cause of traffic congestion and litter may be impeding its operation. So perception about Hafta Bazaar can be contradicting as well, or they can be favoring the Hafta Bazaar as well. Moving ahead, I'll be describing about the origin and the history of the Hafta Bazaars, how the Hafta Bazaars have came into being. So during the Mughal era, these markets were run by traveling salesmen who would set up shops at new locations every day and would come back to each location once a week. But with the urbanization, other nodes were formed where vendors could sell their products on a particular day of the week. And thus the term weekly markets came into picture. This soon became quite popular in Delhi, especially among lower and middle class groups. Before the popularization of mall culture, it was weekly markets in Delhi, which offered a diverse range of products from garments, footwears, utensils, and spices to other daily need goods. Because of these weekly markets, the accessibility of products that were present on at big market centers to local people increased significantly. For the purpose of this research, we termed the collective name for heterogeneous weekly markets like Chor Bazaar, Mahila Bazaar, and Ravivar Bazaar, which differ from localized weekly markets in the aspect of proximity, and refer to them as diversified weekly markets. These diversified weekly markets are different from some other organized retail markets, where the commodities sold in these markets range from small objects of daily use in households that include fruits and vegetables to garments, toys, and electrical gadgets, second-hand clothes, utensils, and other things. Organized retail markets have permanent structures and built environments, but diversified weekly markets do not have any permanent structure in one place. These markets are constantly in the making from one location to another in the metropolitan city. Weekly markets within themselves vary from one another, although having the same properties because of having some different authorizations, in sense that some are legal and some are illegal. While many of these markets are authorized by the state municipal authorities against payment of a fixed amount, others continue to operate without any without any proper approval or record. So what was the problem that these markets faced during the pandemic? The coronavirus pandemic has resulted in disruptive changes in our day-to-day activity patterns and lifestyles. These are not only prompted by the restrictions imposed by government and flexibility offered by the employers, but also by personal awareness to maintain social distance for self-protection and protection of others and interacting with others. Due to the restrictions imposed by government to stop the spread of COVID-19, these markets were completely shut down for a certain time period. All these unprecedented changes and challenges suggest the necessity of gaining a deeper understanding of the behavioral pattern of the emerging society in the new normal. One very important node in the urban society are markets, thus an in-depth study and the functioning of our case study, which is Chor Bazaar, took place. Now I would like to call upon Femi, and she will be discussing about the primary case study, that is Chor Bazaar.
Thank you, Shonit. For our primary case study, we chose Chor Bazaar due to the heterogeneity of products, customer base, and vending types. Kabadi Bazaar, also known as Chor Bazaar, is a weekly market in Delhi that takes place every Sunday. This historical market has been the city's go-to destination for collectibles, utilized products for well longer than a century. It features antiques, used goods, spare automobile parts, clothes, shoes, and many more things. Chor Bazaar sells varied items which could even be damaged, second-hand, or first-copy replicas of branded goods. Although being infamous for its name, Chor Bazaar does not do justice to the shopkeepers who are selling brand new products antiques, and unstolen items like any other market. Next slide. The location of this market has changed multiple times. It started from Ajmeri Gate with a few stores selling scrap and worn-out garments. A few years later, it relocated to the nearby Chowri Bazaar. In 1955, the market was relocated to the vicinity of the old Jama Masjid for a few years before being pushed out to Subhash Park, Kasturba Hospital, with retailers numbering roughly 250 at that time. It moved to a new location on the Ring Road behind the Red Fort in 1982. Years later, it was relocated to Subhash Park in Daryaganj. This turbulent journey continued with yet another new address at the space in front of Jama Masjid, its current location. Next slide. After going for the site visit, we mapped its extent, and its extent starts in front of the Jama Masjid and goes on to the road right in front of Red Fort. We mapped the people densities throughout the market as a part of the on-site observations, and the density of people was found to be much lesser at the extreme ends of the market. The maximum population density was observed from 6 to 8 a.m. and as the day got hotter, after 8 a.m., a decrease in customer footfall was observed. For many, this bazaar is the only source of their livelihood and income. The bazaar usually operates till 11 a.m., but the ever-enthusiastic and chaotic marketplace is completely vacated only after the Delhi police and NCD officials forcefully vacate the area. The authorities do not support this illegal land encroachment, but they are a little flexible in their ways to deal with this bazaar. Next slide. Other observations made during the site visit include the following. There's a heterogeneity in socioeconomic background of the consumer group as well as the shopkeepers. The uniqueness of the market lies in the goods sold, the antiques that were sold there since the Mughal times, even though less in number are still sold there right now. Male population was much, much higher than the female population. The consumer group was not entirely from Delhi, and a mix of backgrounds could be identified. Some of the people who visited the market were there because of its popularity, and others were there because of reasons like buying cheap goods or due to their continued visiting of the market since years. The density of people in the market was high even at 6 in the morning. And even though the arrival of authorities meant removal of the shops as well as the crowd around it, it didn't affect the consumers much, and the market continued to function even after the interference of the officials. Now, Azhar will further continue with the on-site interviews conducted.
Thank you, Femi. We interviewed various vendors and customers at Chowri Bazaar. The choice of respondents was based on product, socioeconomic, and religious heterogeneity. In this process, we got a chance to interact with vendors belonging to various religious groups, age groups, and from various parts of the city. Next slide. Mr. Nadeem, who has been putting up his stall in Meena Bazaar for the last 25 years, he is one of the oldest shopkeepers here at Chowri Bazaar and is following in his father's footsteps, who used to earn his living selling goods at Chowri Bazaar too. Mr. Nadeem provided us with an overview of the weekly market structure and operation at Chowri Bazaar. When asked about the infamous name of this bazaar, he said, "The market received its infamous name, Chowri Bazaar, because of the stolen goods sold there when it was in its early phases. Albeit no stolen goods are sold there today." He stated that the majority of the product are identical duplicates and first copies of well-known brands, with very few genuine branded goods sold there. He also informed us that the market was completely shut for the last 18 months and the crowd has started coming back quite recently. Pointing toward a truck with MCD painted over its body, Mr. Nadeem said, "The authorities still don't allow Chowri Bazaar vendor to put up the shops, and when they come for patrolling, everyone usually has to pack up their stuff and get dismissed, and once they are gone, then only they can put up the shop back." Can you, next slide please. Jyoti Devi, who was selling rug jeans and t-shirt, had shared similar opinions when asked about the impact of pandemic on the functioning of the market and her livelihood. He said, "During the pandemic, I was without work and had no source of income. I live in a rented house and was making my ends meet with the saving I had." She was glad that the market resumed operation, but she is still facing the cruelty of authorities as the status of Chowri Bazaar is still questionable. For Radha, who was selling gym equipment, she find it difficult to pack everything up and vanish as the authorities came for patrolling. She also gave us an insight into the Arto cities of these authorities. If she is unable to clear the area before the police come, all the goods she is selling get confiscated, and then she has to pay a ransom amount to get her goods back. We also got to know that before the pandemic, the situation was more relaxed and flexible. And now after the reopening of the market, the authorities are firmer and stricter towards them. When asked for how many years have they been selling goods at Chor Bazaar, 65-year-old Mr. Jayesh and his wife Maya said, "We have been putting up our shop for last 35, 40 years, when the market used to be around the Red Fort area. Other than Sundays, they sell their artificial jewelry at Mandavali. But the profit they earn at Chor Bazaar on a single day, they aren't able to earn enough the entire week. When inquired about their sources of income during the pandemic lockdown, they said that they were not doing anything and sitting hopelessly at home, surviving on rations supplied to them by the central government." Next slide. We had also interviewed Mr. Karan, who works in IT sector in Gurgaon. He has been visiting Chor Bazaar for many years now, and he visits the market to look out for antiques and certain unique items. He had informed us that the products sold at this market are perfect copies of the branded goods, and one just cannot differentiate between the real and first copy objects from naked eyes. He also clarified that the products sold here are not stolen, but is a myth which has been rumored from late 90s. He also informed us that most of these vendors spend their weekdays usually making copy goods at Raghuveer Nagar market, and they come every Sunday to sell these goods. Another interesting insight he provided us with is that although this market being an unauthorized market, the reason this market is still running is malpractices amongst authorities. The authorities personnel usually charge ₹200 for putting up shops. He also said that the market now is equally crowded as it used to be before the pandemic hit India. The market now is running in full capacity. Next, I would like to call up Shivani.
As found from the interviews, Chor Bazaar is currently an unauthorized market. Therefore, the MCD officials confiscate the goods sold and ask the vendors to vacate the space. The temporality of shop set up there also helps in easily disassembling and vacating the space. Next, please. And also in the consequent reassembly of the setup after the officials have left. Next. So as observed, there were aspects of temporality which were explored in Chor Bazaar as well, as we discussed above, which is heterogeneity in terms of products found there, which are clothes, footwear, dry fruits, spices, household products, gym equipments, and more. In terms of consumer ethnicity, they were from all over the country with varied economic background, inclusive of all economic backgrounds, which I might say. Vendor ethnicity, wherein some shopkeepers who have passed on their profession to future generations but have previously traveled from many other places, and some shopkeepers who have relocated from their native location in pursuit of a better income. In terms of gender, an imbalance in male-female ratio of the consumer group was identified. Next comes multiplicity. The coexistence of permanent shops along with temporary shops that are set up on both daily and weekly basis, and the along with informal shops, give rise to varying use and complex relationship. A balance between the both imparts a certain character to the space it occupies. Next comes rupture. The deterritorialization and reterritorialization of the Chor Bazaar could be understood in two ways. One was setting up and disassembling of shops on a weekly basis, and the second was disassembling and then setting up once the shop is raided by the MCD officials. Next comes perception paradox. As Chor Bazaar is undoubtedly a space that contains a variety of perceptions, one of the impressions is that the bazaar sells stolen products and contributes to traffic congestion and pollution, all of which have resulted in its repeated location changes over the years. Another perception is that it is a historical market and that contrary to its name, Chor Bazaar, it does not sell stolen things, and that the informality of the bazaar and the cheap goods sold there provide labor opportunities and affordable commodities to the poorer sections of the society. One of the reasons why it continues to function long after its location has changed and its authorization has been revoked. Next comes connectivity. The current location of the bazaar as well as its previous location have all been in the proximity of prominent structures, which are Red Fort, Jama Masjid and Salimgarh Fort, and has acted as a node between those very structures, currently as a node between Red Fort and Jama Masjid. Now Akansha will continue.
Yeah, thank you, Shivani. So based on the on-site interviews about the bazaars and the ongoing pandemic, the number of people visiting such markets is far more less than what it used to be before. But the bazaars still have large crowds visiting each day. And due to the reasons like job insecurity and a complete shutdown, which was done by the authorities earlier, there was a decrease in the number of stalls being put up in the market as well. Further, to understand the consumer's perspective about such markets, an online survey was conducted so that we have a diverse respondent group. The survey conducted was not limited to Delhi, as the idea was to understand the presence of such markets, like how they affected the people from different backgrounds, and with questions such that they could be further categorized on the five principles we initially talked about. The intent was to understand the various factors that support or help the working of these weekly markets and the temporality in context of pre and post COVID scenario. So when asked about the presence of weekly markets in the neighborhood, almost 60% of the people confirmed that there were such markets present in the areas. Talking about the heterogeneity, one can observe that these markets are inclusive and cater a diverse user group based on age and economic status. Can you move to the previous slide? Yeah, so what intrigued us more was the functioning of such bazaars, the way multiple activities happen at a place and how they complement each other. So a few questions like the purpose of the visit asked to the people demonstrated how these markets were seen as a whole. It was not just a place for purchase for them, but rather a recreational space as well. And how space distribution being temporary gave rise to efficient space utilization as well. The temporary stalls could coexist with the existing permanent structures present in the area. Also, when asked about the gender ratio, there was heterogeneity in it too, but there was a prominent difference in the genders visiting the market. So coming to the connectivity, the interconnectivity with respect to proximity and ease of communication to reach portrays the importance of Hafta Bazaar since people live. Even though most of these markets were relocated, its shift in its location did not affect the frequency of visits as such, and almost 40% of the people were content with it being temporary. These markets, along with other transportation nodes, form an interconnected network of nodes which complement one another. So the, like for example, when asked about the discovery of such markets, most of the people said that this was due to either a tourist attraction being nearby or it in itself being a tourist attraction. Even though setting up led to overcrowding and traffic congestion in the area in some cases, this also led to emergence of various other amenities and improved conditions in the area in terms of existing resources. A city as a space with various elements is often subjected to perception. Therefore, in order to study various aspects of the space, there is a need to explore the varied perceptions associated with it. Almost 60% of the people who visited these markets was because of for specific goods, and this made the visits quite infrequent. So there were some other reasons as well, being poor hygiene, unsanitary conditions in the area, fear of being robbed or harassed, or lack of presence of authority, and traffic congestion with no proper parking facilities being around. But it was also observed that they were content with the temporary setup. And this was as there was crowd control in the rest of the days as the market was temporary. Although majority of people still do visit these markets, the decline was mainly because people were unsure whether or not the guidelines were being followed and the fear of overcrowding. Further, I'd like to call upon Shivani to conclude the discussion.
The concept of Hafta Bazaar, which is a marketplace that has long reflected the challenges of the urban and poor and those involved in the informal sector, should be promoted. Even as a city expands and develops, these marketplaces continue to exist and thrive with their own set of patterns and networks, providing microcosms of activity that operate inside a larger urban fabric, but with a degree of aloofness. Following the example of Chor Bazaar, it can be seen that these temporary marketplaces have undergone some adjustments post-pandemic. But given the modest severity of these alterations, gradual normalizations of market functioning is likely over time. Even if the pandemic-induced problems are solved, the unauthorized nature of such markets may still be detrimental to their operation. As a result, the necessity for formalization of such places was highlighted in order to ensure the long-term viability of the crucial sector of the economy. Temporality has proven beneficial to the operation of Hafta Bazaar, allowing them to adapt and readapt to a variety of situations, overcoming with time. As a result, architecture and urban design must reconsider permanent solution as the only way forward and instead conceive solutions that can be constantly reformulated and readapted so that ephemeral cities become a feasible option that responds to permanent or temporary condition of a crisis. There is a need to use temporary structures not only as a response to crisis but also as a long-term solution. Thank you.
Thank you, team. Thank you for your presentation. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to post their questions in the chat box or the Q&A forum.
Sambudh, can you please start? I'll just be back.
Okay. So just a second. I think in your research, you had mentioned something very interesting. You said intersection of time and space. Could you elaborate on that? What exactly did you mean? Did you mention this at all? Am I misquoting you?
Sir, basically what we're talking about that the temporal qualities that a weekly market possess or that we have discovered, that we have basically come to understand from a research paper, when they relate, matlab, these temporal qualities, when they're studied in a spatial manner. So can you repeat the question?
You said intersection of time and space. In time and space work together in a space place like this. What does it mean? I think Chris Alexander you were quoting or something. I don't know which remember. I think probably Chris Alexander. Okay.
So the idea to study time and space initially was we wanted to describe how we could call something as temporary. Like we wanted to study various aspects as something can be permanent, but like something in the whole moment of its life, at some point of time, it would be permanent. But like as a whole, we just wanted to study, like we just wanted to convey that how something like could be defined temporary and like to what extent. Would
more than that, you know, it kind of denotes that it's a kinetic and dynamic situation that is constantly changing. You know, week to week, day to day, it keeps on changing. You know, it doesn't have a definite form. It keeps on, and every time they set up the stores, it's a different configuration maybe, unless there are very specified places where they sit. That's normally what happens in the municipal markets. They have assigned carts and all that with numbers on, and they occupy those places only. But in a place like this, probably the whole the geometry of the place, you know, and the morphology of the place keeps on changing. You know, so that probably. And it's never the same, you know, day to day or month to month or week to week, whatever. So that's one. And the other question I have is, how do you place this in the matrix of the discussions that we're having in the seminar? Where do you place this? Where does it fit in? What aspect of it is that you want to highlight that will fit in into this framework of
So to answer your question, sir, what we initially started with the research was that we wanted to study the difference between temporary and permanence. What are the basic difference between a temporary event and a permanent event?
Okay.
So when the situation like pandemic hit our country, it's everyone knows it's not a permanent situation, right? So pandemic came and no one was prepared for pandemic. So it was a temporary event. So what we wanted to study further was that what are the effects or what are the impacts of this temporary event on an already happening temporary situation, which is a weekly market. Weekly market in itself is not a permanent event, right? So moreover, Chor Bazaar, unlike other weekly markets, there are various other factors which make Chor Bazaar an interesting case study. So said, unlike other weekly markets which are being organized on a daily on a regular basis, not daily basis, at specific locations, Chor Bazaar is at the very first place. It's not taking place at the same location over the years. So the location of Chor Bazaar has changed over the years due to many reasons. So it was already an unpredictable and temporary event which was going on for years, and we further wanted to study that how after the pandemic has hit the country, how a market like Chor Bazaar will adapt to it, whether it will adapt to it or not adapt to it.
Exactly the
that
point.
Was the purpose of the study.
It is more resilient than any other fixed kind of
exactly.
Market.
Exactly. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Whether it will adapt this, and if it will.
Exactly.
Yes, sir.
Exactly. This would respond more, in a more flexible way.
Exactly.
To
sir.
Your
exactly.
needs and, yes, the shape it takes or the
yes,
density
sir.
Or
yes,
number
sir.
Of people. So yeah, that's an interesting notion, but I wish you could have brought this out a little more definitely. You know, you don't say this in so many words. You know, I mean, you should have concluded with this, that this is something that's more resilient and it kind of responds to the
changes
the moving situation. That
yes,
is
sir.
Very, very liquid, fluid situation. That's,
yes, sir.
Good. Anubhaji, batayye.
Ma'am, you're on
mute. Ma'am, you're on mute.
Sorry. I said thanks. That was an interesting presentation, and this is something that I won't say I worked on it, but I have been sort of reading or following for a while. A couple of things. One is that the blanket term Hafta Bazaar can be misleading. There are many types of Hafta Bazaars. In fact, when you started your presentation, I thought you were talking of the weekly markets, which still happen very, very regularly in all cities in India, including Delhi. There is the Mangalwari and the Shaniwari and the Ravivari, which are essential day-to-day goods markets, and they have happened through the pandemic or just the first lockdown, they did not happen, but after that, after last July, they have been happening all over the city. Okay. So what you're talking of you're talking of two very specific situations. You briefly mentioned the Book Bazaar early on, and then you basically went to the Chor Bazaar. Now these are very, very specific. They occur every Sunday, but they're not like the Hafta Bazaar. They are like, at least in my opinion, they are like these, they are almost like iconic city events, right? They have a historicity and as well as they have a legacy that they follow. And as you said, the Chor Bazaar has moved location a lot of time. In fact, the Daryaganj Book Bazaar also has moved location a lot of time. And the dissolution has got as much to do with pandemic, if at all, as with the planning norms. So the Book Bazaar in Daryaganj, for example, had been shunted or shifted out thanks to this notion that it was creating clutter and traffic jams and so on and so forth, and there was actually a people's movement which kind of led to its reinstation. And the similar thing, the only thing is, well, of course, sadly, as we see again, that the Book Bazaar attracted, well, people who read books, and therefore there was a concentrated effort on the social media and all of that which kind of protected that market. Chor Bazaar, on the other hand, invites people, as you said, from all walks of life who may not launch such a concentrated effort to save it. But that said, it has survived for many years. I see it is extremely difficult that it will die away anytime soon. So, however, as I would just like to say that I don't think it's a Hafta Bazaar. I think it's a legacy market. It happens weekly, all right,
But it's got a different morphology, it's got a different history, and it's got a different reason for being. That said, what I did want to say was that when you talk of the Hafta Bazaar, if I was to talk of the Hafta Bazaars in Delhi, they have a very, very set pattern, in the sense that it's the same set of people, it's the same set of vendors who move from one market to another. It's the same guy who sets up shop in, say, in front of Lady Sri Ram College one day, and then the same guy moves to near Saket the other day. And I'm just talking again of South Delhi. And I'm sure, and it's a very well thought out system where there is the person who provides the tables on which these wares are displayed, and the trucks and everything. It's an ecosystem completely. So that's how the Hafta Bazaar works, and it's a extremely established ecosystem. And probably also acknowledged in the police or the traffic police rules, so they are allowed for that, which is not the case with Chor Bazaar. Chor Bazaar is more entrepreneurial, unlike the Hafta Bazaar, which are like systemic weekly markets. Chor Bazaar is more entrepreneurial, and therefore it is more interesting in that sense. As Sambuddha said, I don't know what was the point, but yes, it is something, and it as it's a case study in resilience for sure, because it's been, I mean, I know that I have first visited Chor Bazaar as a child, and I know that it's definitely been around for 30 plus years or 40 plus years, and I'm sure it's been around for longer. So it's a study. In fact, I would say that it's almost like a heritage thing. Whatever the nature of goods might be sold here, there, it's almost like an heritage precinct and or a heritage temporal precinct. And to say that it is something that is changing may be true and yet not true. And there are many examples in India, in all the Sarafas or in the all the jewelry quadrants in India, whether that's in Indore, whether that's in Ahmedabad or wherever, what happens is that the temporality, since you use the term temporality, is very important. So what would happen in a Sarafa is that after the shops shut at 9 o'clock, the food market comes in, which continues till 2 a.m. or something like that, after which there's a bit of a cleaning, and then the milk, the cows come in, and that's the wholesale milk market. And once the cows and milk is wrapped up, by 6 a.m. or something, the vegetable market kicks in, and that market moves out by 8 or 9 when the streets are cleaned and the regular Sarafa opens. So that was also an eyes on street kind of a concept. So these are, I think, it's a heritage situation which should be treated as thus. And maybe that would give us some interesting views or interesting filters to look at it, rather than just looking at it like a weekly market. That is all I wanted to say, actually.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. We definitely understood your point. So, ma'am, that was our aim. Basically, we wanted to study a market which is unique in its kind. So that's why we came up with Chor Bazaar. So initially, we thought of other case studies as well. For example, the example that you gave of Sarafa Bazaar, so similar case studies, Manik Chowk in Ahmedabad. So as you said, yeah, so Manik Chowk functions in a similar way. So at 6 a.m., the functioning of a Manik Chowk is very different from what it is during the afternoon or evening.
I gave the example of Manik Chowk only. I said Indore and Ahmedabad.
Okay, yeah, Ahmedabad, yes, ma'am, Manik Chowk. So the only reason why we took Chor Bazaar was because of these certain factors, that firstly, the status of the market is questionable, and plus it adds on to the heritage of the city. So these were certain factors which made us choose this bazaar as the topic for our case study.
So perhaps the nomenclature of your thesis, your research, then should not have been Hafta Bazaar.
Okay, ma'am, I got your point.
Sorry to interrupt you, sorry.
Yeah, to answer that, we actually differentiated from a normal Hafta Bazaar, Chor Bazaar, as the regular Hafta Bazaar. They are classified as localized weekly market that come under an authority or an association or an NGO. Rather, for Hafta Bazaar, we named it as a diversified weekly market, which adds, there's another factor that adds to its temporality, which is unauthorization. So that's how we differentiate between those. And as this is a very important factor of that temporality coined, like it's an authorization which helps in its resilience. That's why we chose Chor Bazaar over the regular Hafta Bazaars, because they have a circularized.
I'm not contesting that at all. I'm just saying that the term Hafta Bazaar can be a bit misleading.
Okay, sure. Ma'am, we got your point.
Ma'am, also to add up to what you said initially about them being a heritage space rather than just weekly markets. So when we were studying about markets as such, we came to know that, you know, there were places which are only treated as heritage spaces. So while studying, an interesting point which we felt was that treating spaces not just as something to look up to, like not just a heritage space, but also a space where there could be overlap. You know, like things could be useful and also be a part, like a heritage. So like the idea was studying this specific bazaar was that, you know, we see how both can coexist, like the heritage part of it and also the usability.
Yeah, so there's no contesting that the heritage can be usable, right? Yeah. And the term which probably is used is living heritage.
Yeah.
You know, they're renovating the Chhatta Bazaar in Lal Redford now.
Yeah.
That used to be the Royal Market, no? Inside the fort.
Inside
so they're doing it now. So that will be, I hope it will become very successful and nice. Yeah.
I think as a continuation, it would have been interesting to see how Meena Bazaar has transformed. I mean, what it was meant to be and what it has become. So these are all sort of offshoots of that same bazaar.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Of the Red Fort and its precincts.
There is a question in the comment section from Mr. Anuband. Have you come across instances where the vendors in this informal market conducted business elsewhere individually during lockdown but came back to this place the day it reopened? Was there a similar response found from shoppers? Is the place attachment contributed in resilience of informal bazaar?
To answer the first part of your question, sir, maximum vendors that we interviewed, so they said that they were basically homeless. They were not homeless. They were living in rented houses. They did not have any other sources of income. They did not put up their shops anywhere else. They did not go back or anything. They were just living in the rented houses and they were surviving on the rations supplied to them by Delhi government or central government. Now, the second part is the police attachment contributing resilience of the informal bazaar. Place attachment contributing resilience to informal bazaar. Sir, place attachment, isn't you talking about this current location or what?
Yes, the current location, yes.
Sir, so as we already mentioned that this bazaar, the Chor Bazaar, it has already changed locations so many times over the years. So I think that feature of the Chor Bazaar that it can adapt to any place it moves to, that adds resilience to the functioning of the Chor Bazaar, not the attachment to its current location. I'm not sure, sir, whether the market would still be functioning in the same location in the next 10 or 15 years, but I can be sure about this fact that wherever the market will be functioning, it can adapt to the situations in that 10 or 15 years gap period. So I don't think that attachment to the place adds on to the resilience of the of this Chor Bazaar. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, team. Thank you, jury, for the comments and feedback, and we thank the audience for their questions. And this is the last session for today. With the end of day one, we would like to bring the seminar 2021 to a brief intermission, to be resumed tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. On behalf of the Seminar 2021 team, we would like to thank the jury members for their valuable insight and feedback for all the groups. We also would like to thank all the students, faculty, experts, friends, and family members, and many more of you gathered here for your unwavering patience and interest throughout the presentation. For without you, this wouldn't have been a success. We truly hope we've given you something to take back home, and we look forward to seeing you all tomorrow. Thank you once again. We wish you had all had a pleasant evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gunjan, we stay.
So shall we continue here or we go to the breakout rooms, Tilak? How do we do it?
Yes, ma'am. Aman?
So thank you, Tilak, Joanne, and Ayushi. You guys have managed it very well. Thank you so much.
We do hope so, ma'am. Thanks for the compliment.
Sure, ma'am. maybe you guys can leave. There are no other participants here, and then we can continue here.
Tilak.
Yes, ma'am.
You asked me to introduce our esteemed jury members.
Ma'am, we Ma'am, we did say, I guess. Joanne, you did, right?
I remember, yes, I said, yes.
You said?
Yes.
Well, I never heard. Okay, so shall I tell you what you are now? Sambodhan Anubha? Well, Sambodh is neither need any introduction, actually. Sambodh's been a visiting faculty for decades now, right?
Yeah.
Decades. Teen decades ho gaye, mere ko pata hai. So when we were talking as finding out, wondering who to get as jury, you were there for sure, I thought. Anubha has been a student, and I'm very proud to say that she's now a professor in her own right. She's a professor and director of the School of Design at Anant National University. I'm really very proud of you, Anubha.
Thank you.
She has given back to her alma mater, coming in and out as elective instructor, as